welcome each and every one of you for today's Bhakti Shastri class. We are continuing with Ishu Upanishad, and today we're going to start from verse number 12 and 13. So let's start with verse number 12. If you're able to discuss that enough, we'll go to verse number 13 today. So starting with the presentation. So text number 12. So before we start, so this is the sub part of section 4. The first section was the verse number 1 to 3, where Ishavasa principle was discussed, followed up by those who believe and live by Ishavasa principle, what happens to them, and to those who do not believe in Ishavasa principles, what happened to them. That was the text 3. The next section was verse number 4 and 5, which spoke about the inconceivable nature of the Lord. And Srila Prabhupada, through that two verses, established the personal form of the Lord. Then 6 to 8 was the third section of Ishu Upanishad, where who can understand this inconceivable nature of the Lord? The Mahabhagavat, the great devotee of the Lord, his attributes, his vision was described in verse number 6, 7 and 8. And then we come to the section 4 of Ishu Upanishad, from verse number 9 to verse number 14, which are subdivided into two sections, 9 to 11 and 12 to 14. So far we have, in verse number 9 to 11, we have learnt about what is Vidya and Avidya. We have also received guidelines on practice on about what is knowledge and what is Avidya. And what's going to be the subject matter of the next subset of this section 4, from verse number 12 to verse number 14, is about the right kind of upasana, the right kind of worship and non-worship. Here in this verses, the discussion will be about the upasana of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, upasana of the devatas, upasana of the impersonal form of the Lord, and upasana even of a man who claims to be God or whose followers put their guru to be at an equal level of the Supreme Lord. So what are the right practices and the wrong practices would be the subject matter of this set of verses. So let's start with text number 12 and let's recite line after line. Andham tama praveshanti.
Andham tama praveshanti.
Ye asambhutim upasate.
Ye asambhutim upasate.
Tato bhuya ivate tamo.
Tato bhuya ivate tamo.
Yayu sambhutyam rataha.
Yayu sambhutyam rataha.
So I'll not have that facility here, but if you go into your handbook, and you quickly go to the ninth verse. Let's read out the ninth verse, if in case you have a handbook with you. What does the ninth verse says? And let's compare line by line the verse number 12 that we're reading. The verse number 9 says, Andham tama praveshanti.
Andham tama praveshanti.
Is the same line what is mentioned in the text 12. And now a slight difference. Ye avidyam upasate.
Ye avidyam upasate.
Once again the same line, only asambhutim has replaced avidyam. That's the difference between text number 9 and text number 12 that we're reading. Then the third line is same. Tato bhuya ivate tamo.
Tato bhuya ivate tamo.
Yayu sambhutyam rataha.
Yayu sambhutyam
rataha. And in that, sorry, I read from here in text number 9. Yayu vidyayam rataha. So vidyam has been replaced by sambhutyam, and avidya has been replaced by asambhutim. That is the difference here. So just like text 9 described, one who worship avidya, andham tama praveshanti, goes into the darker regions of existence. More so are the one who claim to be in knowledge. Vidyayam rataha, they go into further darkness. So who are vidyayam? Were described in text number 9. These are false spiritual gurus, or you can call them Vedavadratas, who are learned in scriptures, but they only draw conclusions for sense gratification. In other words, when knowledge is not utilized for re-establishing one's relationship with the Supreme Lord, the knowledge which deprives one of regaining its true consciousness is said to be a larger avidya than avidya itself. Similarly, in this subject matter of verse number 12 to 14, there are two new terminologies, sambhutim, asambhutim. What sambhuti or sambhuti means? Fully independent. Asambhuti means which is dependent. So here, andam tama pravishanti ye asambhutim upasate. So as a translation goes, I would need help for somebody to read out because I have a bad throat. So somebody can read out quickly the translation. Anyone wants to do it online? From otherwise, we can have somebody from here. Hare Krishna. So those who are engaged in the worship of the devatas, so that's the point, enter into the darkest region. So that is asambhuti. Devatas are dependent beings, they are not independent. Nasambhuti. the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Sambhuti means fully independent. Who is fully independent? The Supreme Personality of Godhead. And the Sanskrit word for it is swarat. Janmadi asyata anvayad itrascate shobhigna swarat. As described in the first canto, first chapter, first verse of Srimad Bhagavatam. Swarat. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is fully independent. That Supreme Personality of Godhead is understood in three features. Described in the first canto, Vadanti tat tatvavidas tatso yajnanam advayam brahmeti paramatmeti bhagwan iti shabdate. Brahmeti paramatmeti bhagwan iti shabdate. These are three levels of realization of the sambhuti or absolute truth. So the sambhuti which is described here is of the lowest level, Brahman level. And that is, which is said, those who worship this sambhutim, the Brahman level of realization, are put into further darkness. So it seems contradiction, right? When Lord exists in three levels, he has his existence in three features. Why sambhutim worshippers are said to be put into darkness? Because as the verse Prabhupada purport will clarify, this sambhutim which is discussed in 12th verse, as been talked about, they put in a darker ignorance, are the ones who reject the other two levels of realization. They say this is the only true existence, there is nothing beyond. That is why they said the followers of this path or this understanding goes into darker ignorance. And this is none other than Mayavad or Mayavadi. So today's subject matter, we're going to take a look at Prabhupada's purport for this, and the next verse is a little slightly long. But particularly in this verse, we're going to study about Mayavad, what is Mayavad, what is the origin and the history of Mayavad, and things like that. So let's begin with our presentation slide deck again. Let's go back. So text number 13 and 14, I'm just giving the translation here. Somebody online can quickly read out. These are exactly same as verse number 10 and verse number 11 of the same text, Ishopanishad. Somebody please read out the translation.
It is said that one result is obtained by worshipping the supreme cause of all causes, and that another result is obtained by worshipping what is not supreme. All this is heard from the undisturbed authorities who clearly explained it. Text number 14. One should know perfectly the personality of Godhead Sri Krishna and his transcendental name, form, qualities and pastimes, as well as a temporary material creation with its temporary demigods, men and animals. When one knows these, he surpasses death and the ephemeral cosmic manifestation with it. And in the eternal kingdom of God, he enjoys his eternal life of bliss and knowledge.
So let's take a quick look of what is sambhutim and asambhutim means in 12th, 13th, 14th. Asambhutim in the current verse means devatas, dependent. As asambhuti means, sambhuti means impersonal absolute. So those who worship devatas, they go into darkness. Now why worship of devatas are being rejected? Why it is said they're put into a darkness? Andham tama pravishanti. Any quick answer or thought to it? We're going to also, in today's discussion, going to talk about demigod worship at length. Demigod worship is prescribed in the scriptures itself. In the second canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, in the third chapter, if I'm correct, there are set of verses which talks about if somebody wants to have a beautiful wife, somebody wants to have successful profession, you worship this devta, this goddess and all that. All that is given. I'll not tell you the verses, huh? That I'll keep it as a secret. I don't want you to get distracted and go and find out those verses. But, you know, this is prescribed, this is given in the scriptures. So, at one level, third chapter of Bhagavad Gita itself says, Krishna says, you know, I have created a system of, mutual interdependency between the devatas and the living entities. Yet, simultaneously, the scriptures reject demigod worship. The Bhagavad Gita itself rejects. Lord Shri Krishna himself speaks and says that, you know, the demigod worshippers are mudas. So, what's the reason behind it? And can we request everyone have the cameras on, as we have discussed before also? So these are the two things, demigod worship and what is Mayavad, we're going to discuss at length today. But before we begin with, any thoughts? Why demigod worshippers are kind of rejected in Vedic scriptures? Why they are spoken about, we'll discuss that later on. Why demigod worship is encouraged, we'll speak about later on. But right now I'm asking a question, why would demigod worship is rejected, particularly in texts like Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam? Mother Ishma.
Thank you, Shri
Guruji. Dhanvats.
Basically, demigods are servants of the Lord, and the Lord is the Yagneshwar. So any offering done to the demon will go to the Lord. So it's better to do the service directly to the Lord instead of the
demigods. Fine. What else? Shashank Prabhu, the correct answer, I'm looking for some specifics.
Hare Krishna Guruji.
Yes.
So the basic reason is that the worship of demigod is associated with the sense gratification.
Okay. And very nice.
And then more we indulge in sense gratification, ultimately we fall into ignorance.
Okay, you're close to the answer that I'm looking forward to. But you've got a little inch forward now. Mother Sumana.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Demigods itself are temporary, Prabhuji, and the worship done to the demigods is temporary.
Yes.
That's why it is not suggested.
That's a key point. And that is what does Veda teaches actually? Asatoma satgamaya tam soma jyotirgamaya. So whole Vedic knowledge is organized in such a way to guide a living entity from the world of temporary to the world of eternity. What is the use of all our worship if it is temporary at the end of the day? Yes or no? Because demigod themselves are temporary, their positions are temporary. Please understand, we loosely identify the position holder with the name of the position, which means Indra is not the name of the person, God Indra, that's the name of the position. Just like Chief Minister of Maharashtra. Every 5 years, well, in today's time, maybe every second year or third year, depending on the dynamics in politics, what goes on. So the Chief Minister keeps changing, but the post is of Chief Minister. Indra keeps changing, Surya Devta keeps changing, Vayu Devta keeps changing, but the position is still the same, but the persons, different people keep occupying. So it is temporary. So that's a key point for which scriptures like Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam reject demigod worship, because these are the scriptures which teaches us how to attain to eternal life. Particularly scriptures like Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam, they are not the one that talks about dharma, artha, kama, moksha. These are not the scripture which talks about purushartha. They only talk about eternal life. And when the goal is eternal life, anything temporary will be rejected. Any temporary relief will be rejected. Therefore, scriptures like Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam totally reject demigod worship. Fine. So let's go back to the presentation again. Text number 13, Asambhutim again, anything other than Supreme Personality Godhead, and Asambhuti means Supreme Personality Godhead. Text 13 again will talk about those who worship anything other than Supreme Lord and worship Supreme Lord will have two different set of results. In the 12th verse, it has already been established those who worship anything other than Supreme Personality of Godhead will remain in the world of temporary. Text number 13 says, It's not that all paths lead to same goal. It is not that somebody is worshipper of Vishnu would also remain in the material world. Different path takes you to different destination. And text number 14 will talk about what happens to those who worship the Supreme Personality Godhead, what destination they receive. So 12th have already established the destination of those who worship anything other than the Supreme Lord. 13 emphasizes that both results are different, and 13 describes the destination of those who worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So text number 12, a connection, mantra 11 describes that one must obtain knowledge while understanding nescience to transcend material conception. Now mantra 12 will describe two kinds of people who cannot do this. And what will be the result? Who cannot discriminate between Vidya and Avidya? About them will be spoken about. What's the main theme of this particular text? Impersonalist with a tiny brain power and the unintelligent demigod worshippers cannot understand the absolute truth. So Srila Prabhupada in his purport is going to build up on the theme of demigod worshippers as well as impersonalist, as well as pious materialist, those who try to understand God by their tiny brain. But Lord cannot be understood by the tiny brain of the living entities. So why do people approach devatas? That will be the second question Prabhupada will raise in the purport. People approach devatas to remove their temporary inconveniences for at the cost of permanent inconvenience or the cost of permanent convenience, which means they go to devatas to remove their temporary inconvenience, just like, you know, financial problem, legal issues, whatnot. But the end result is they have to still suffer through birth, death, old age, and disease that they cannot get themselves free. The impersonalists, on the other hand, they think the absolute truth is not a person itself. And therefore, because they reject the form of the Lord, they reject the Lord Himself, therefore they are said to be a kind of a covered atheism where they take shelter of scriptures and misguide people. So this will be the more or less the subject matter. So let's take a look. So the whole purport can be divided into three sections. First is what we're going to take a look now. Even demigods, Prabhupada make a point, even demigods and rishis misunderstand the absolute truth to be impersonal. So first paragraph to third paragraph, we're going to see where Prabhupada talks about the problem with the impersonal conception. And second thing Prabhupada will speak about, one cannot understand the absolute truth by his own might. Second section of the purport is from paragraph number 4 to paragraph number 7. Where Prabhupada, after talking about impersonal conception, Prabhupada will talk about demigod worshippers. How demigod worshippers, they stay in the material world because their object of worship is temporary. Similarly, the result given by that temporary object of worship, which means devata, is also temporary. And the final section from paragraph number 7 to paragraph number 10, Prabhupada explains how these impersonals, which are Mayavadis, they misled, misguide people and send them into a darker condition of life, which Prabhupada will talk as a pseudo-religionist, how they are the worst offenders and they are the greatest threat to mankind. And to overcome this misunderstanding about the absolute truth, Prabhupada concludes with, can only be done by the help of devotional service. With that, let's go back to the screen now. And let's start reading from the purport. Please, somebody read out. We're going to read the first three paragraphs. One by one, we can read it.
The Sanskrit word asambhuti refers to those who have no independent existence. Sambhuti is the absolute personality of Godhead, who is absolutely independent of everything. In the Bhagavad Gita 10.2, the absolute personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna states, Name viduhu suragana, prabhavam na mahashayaha, aham adirhi devana, maharshi nam cha sarvasaha. Neither the hosts of demigods nor the great sages know my origin or opulences, for in every respect I am the source of the demigods and sages. Thus, Krishna is the origin of the powers delegated to demigods, great sages and mystics. although they are endowed with great powers, these powers are limited, and thus it is very difficult for them to know how Krishna himself appears by his own internal potency in the form of a man.
So Prabhupada opens the paragraph by making a statement that nobody can understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore, Prabhupada quoted from the 10th chapter, verse number 2, even the best of the suras, which mean devatas, and best of the rishis, even they cannot understand the source of their creation. Aham adirhi devanam, because I have created them. So any kind of austerity, amount of mysticism and knowledge cannot reveal the Lord. That's not possible. That is the first point being established here. And second thing, a clear definition of sambhutim and asambhutim. What is asambhutim? Which is dependent. Sambhutim means swarat, fully independent. That's the point. Let's go to the next paragraph. Somebody please read out.
Many philosophers and great rishis or mystics try to distinguish the absolute truth from the relative by their tiny brain power. They can only help them reach the negative conception of the absolute without realizing any positive trace of the absolute. Definition of the absolute by negation is not complete. Such negative definition led one to create a concept of one's own. Thus, one imagines that absolute must be formless and without qualities. Such negative qualities are simply by reversal of relative material qualities and are therefore also relative. By conceiving of the absolute in this way, one can at the utmost reach the impersonal effigence of God known as Brahman, but one cannot make further progress to Bhagwan, the personality of God.
Hare Krishna. Imagine you have gone to attend a marriage ceremony and you're a musician. Let's take hypothetically a few examples. So imagine that all of us imagine we have gone to attend a marriage ceremony or some public event. So one of you is a musician, another one is a food connoisseur, in other words, expert in food and dining. And the third devotee could be an of artistic ability, where he likes to organize and decorate the tent and pandal and whatnot. You know, we have already spoken of somebody into music. Fourth could be in fashion industry, where he, you know, he likes to dress people with a nice kind of garments and ornaments and whatnot. Imagine these three, four people go to an event. How each one of them would describe that event? The one who has a lot of taste for music and songs, for him the highlight of the whole event would be, oh, do you remember at the entry of that marriage pandal there was shehnai wala sitting and they were playing some shehnai. That fellow was little off the saregama. The other person was doing okay, and then when he will go inside he'll remember, yes, do you know that there was a disc or some discotheque was going on that was too loud. This would be the perception of the one who is into music. The one who is a food connoisseur, who has a taste for food and dining, he would only speak about, you remember that they served a hot jalebi? You know, it was a little extra fried and there was a little less sweet into it. Now, he would not remember even seeing a shehnai wala, what to speak about listening to the shehnai music. For him, that doesn't exist. For him, only what exists is a food and dining that was there. And the third person who is into much about organizing events, you know, stage setup and all that, he would only remember how good or bad was the arrangement of the event. And the fourth person who was into fashion industry, he will only remember how the bride and the groom were dressed. Were they dressed appropriately or they could have been had better dress and whatnot? Yes or no, do you all agree? All of us, each one of us, look at the world from our own perceptions. That is a point being established here. We cannot search out the absolute truth, who is beyond all perceptions, because we can only perceive the reality to the degree our perceptions allows us. So by the mercy of the Lord, we are allowed to perceive him up to his impersonal form, Brahma Jyoti. Beyond that, without his mercy, we cannot realize him further. Is that making sense? Let me make this point, it's a very important point. I hope this example of perception has made it something clear to you. The point I'm trying to make is, by the mercy of the Lord, He has allowed us to understand Him by our own strength, by our own perceptions, up to the limit of Brahman realization, which is a formless realization. Beyond formless realization, we cannot understand Him by our own endeavors. Only we can understand Him by our endeavors when our endeavors are meant to please Him. And when He is pleased, He is Swaraj, if He so desired, then He can reveal the realization which is beyond the formless realization. Therefore, here Prabhupada is explaining, no amount of philosopher, no amount of a scholar, no amount of mystic or yogi can understand the absolute form of the Lord. That is just not possible. And therefore, Prabhupada quoted the 10th chapter, verse number 2 also. Alright? So, to say because I, on my own ability, am not able to understand, to put a full stop to the form of the Lord, saying Lord to be formless, is said to be an offense. Is said to be a biggest blunder which the yogis and gyanis do. Thinking that this far only we can go and therefore this is the only reality. But that's not the fact, because Vedic scriptures reveals us. Srimad Bhagavatam reveals us Vaikuntha, reveals us about Vaikuntha Vasis, reveals us, tells us about how Vaikuntha exists beyond this material world. So scriptures teaches us there is another reality, which may or may not be able to realize, we may not be able to realize at this point of time, but the reality exists. That's the point. Let's go to the next paragraph.
Mental speculators do not know that the absolute personality of Godhead is Krishna, that the impersonal Brahman is the glaring effulgence of his transcendental body, or that the Paramatma, the super soul, is his all-pervading planetary representation. Nor do they know that Krishna has his eternal form with its transcendental qualities of eternal bliss and knowledge. The dependent demigods and great sages imperfectly consider him to be a powerful demigod, and they consider the Brahman effulgence to be the absolute truth. But the devotees of Krishna, by dint of their surrendering unto him and their unalloyed devotion, can know that he is the absolute person and that everything emanates from him. Such devotees continuously render loving service unto Krishna, the fountainhead.
Hare Krishna. So how do we understand beyond our perception? How do we understand the reality which is beyond our perception? So the third paragraph mentions it is only possible by dint of devotional service. So let's go back to the slide deck. Let's take a look. The summary of these three things that we have spoken right now. So where is it? Yeah, let's go one by one. The position of the absolute truth, who can't understand the absolute truth, and way out. Position absolute truth is Sambhutim Swarat. Krishna is absolute personality Godhead, 10th chapter verse number 2. He is a source of Aham Adirhi Devanam, and he appears by his own internal potency in the form of a man. Who cannot understand absolute truth? Mental speculators, demigod worshippers, and pseudo devotees. This will be discussed ahead now. And what is the way out? Only way to approach Supreme Personality of Godhead is
bhakti.
Bhakti. That is what discussed right now. Bhakti, or taking shelter of a bhakta. Now we come to the second part of the purport. After a little bit introducing about how mental speculators cannot understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead, what about demigod worshippers? That will be the discussion now. Demigod worshippers stay in the dark material world. Paragraph number 4 to paragraph number 7. So let's start reading. Hare Krishna.
The Bhagavad Gita, 7:20-23, it says that only an intelligent man, bewildered person, driven by a strong desire for sense gratification, worship the demigods for the temporary relief of temporary problems. Since the living being is materially entangled, it has to be relieved from material bondage, entirely to attain permanent relief on the spiritual plane, where intellect, life and knowledge temporarily relieve of our difficulties by worshipping but dependent demigods, then best the only temporary benefit. Rather, we must worship the absolute personality of Godhead, Krishna, who is all attractive and who can bestow upon us complete freedom from material bondage by taking us home, back to God.
So the goal of Vedas is asatoma sadgamaya, temporary to eternal. So what's the point of demigod worship when despite all that upasana we stay in the world of darkness? Let's go to the next paragraph where Prabhupada quotes from the 7th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. We'll look at these references more in details after reading this paragraph. Somebody else read out, please.
It is stated in the Bhagavad Gita 7.23 that the worshippers of the demigods can go to the planets of the demigods. The moon worshippers can go to the moon. The sun worshippers go to the sun, etc. Modern scientists are now venturing to the moon with the help of rockets. But this is not really a new attempt. With their advanced consciousness, human beings are naturally inclined to travel in outer space and to reach other planets, either by spaceships, mystic powers, or demigod worship. In the Vedic scripture, it is said that one can reach other planets by any one of these three ways. But the most common way is by worshipping the demigod presiding over a particular planet. In this way, one can reach the moon planet, the sun planet, and even Brahmalok, the topmost planet in this universe. However, all planets in the material universe are temporary residences. The only permanent planets are Vaikuntha Lokas. These are found in the spiritual sky, where the personality of Godhead himself predominates. As Lord Krishna states in the Bhagavad Gita 8.16, A Brahma Bhuvanal Loka Punar Avartino Arjuna Maam Vidyutu Kaunteya Punar Janmana Vidyate. From the highest planet in the material world down to the lowest, all are places of misery wherein repeated birth and death takes place. But one who attains my abode, O son of Kunti, never takes birth again.
Hare Krishna. Once again, the similar point. How demigod worship is futile because it does not award one access to eternal life. That is the point. That's the theme being continued here. Please go ahead. Now, what is the problem if we don't get eternal life? The material world in itself is considered to a place of darkness. And what is an example? Natada bhasate suryo nashashanka na pavaka yad katvana nivatate tadhama paramamava. So 15th chapter, verse 5 or 6. So this is Krishna describing the spiritual world. It says, natad bhasate suryo. There is no need for sun, moon, electricity. It is self-illumined. And that self-illumination is nothing but the rays emanating from the body of the Lord. Now in the material world, it's not self-illumined. You need sunlight. If there is no sunlight, it becomes a place of darkness. Therefore, being in this world itself is said to be a hellish condition of life. Hellish condition of life doesn't mean to send you to some specific hell. That is additional bonus with compound interest. Alright? You know? Otherwise, being in this material world itself is a hellish condition of life. It is not that it is something wonderful. That is a point here. That's a point again and again being brought about. Eternal life and temporary life. Let's go to the next paragraph.
Sri Isa Upanishad points out that one who worships the demigods and attains to the material planets still remains in the darkest region of the universe. The whole universe is covered by the gigantic material elements. It is just like a coconut covered by a shell and half filled with water. Since its covering is airtight, the darkness within is dense, and therefore the sun and the moon are required for illumination. Outside the universe is the vast and unlimited Brahmajyoti expansion, which is filled with Vaikuntha Lokas. The biggest and highest planet in the Brahmajyoti is Krishna Loka or Goloka Vrindavana, where the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna himself resides. Lord Sri Krishna never leaves Krishna Loka. Although he dwells there with his eternal associates, he is omnipresent throughout the complete material and spiritual cosmic manifestations. This fact has already been explained in Mantra 4. The Lord is present everywhere, just like the sun, yet he is situated in one place, just as the sun is situated in its own undeviating orbit.
Hare Krishna. So Prabhupada here further elaborates what we quoted, Natad Bhasate Suryo. So Prabhupada is saying, talking about how this world, material world, is nothing but a place of darkness, and that's the same point which is discussed, is being discussed or described in the paragraph of Srila Prabhupada. Let's go to the next paragraph.
The problems of life cannot be solved simply by going to the moon planet or to some other planet above or below.
I'll just add a point about it, Mother, then we continue.
Yes,
so Prabhupada is again bringing upon the attention on the point which was mentioned by Prabhupada before and two paragraphs prior, where it was mentioned that how people have this, you know, modern scientists are now trying to go to the moon with the help of rockets, which is not really a new attempt. Suppose that man have this nature to go to other planets or higher planets. So Prabhupada now in this paragraph is saying the problems of life will not be solved going to the sun or the moon planet as a modern scientist are attempting to go. What are the problems of life? Birth, death, old age and disease continues even despite going to different planets. Now Prabhupada talked about the pseudo worshippers, you know, after making a point about the problems of life will not be solved by modern advancement or else by going to higher planets. Then Prabhupada makes a switch to pseudo-religionists who on the name of God runs their own business and gives false promises to people saying that if you do so and so, they will elevate them to higher planets to enjoy their life to the fullest. I believe there is one very popular religion today who professes this kind of a theology, ideology, where they say, on the name of dash, 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 go and kill the innocent people and there are many beautiful ladies waiting for you in the heaven. That is what the whole idea. So pseudo-religions is being described in the followers. So please go ahead and read it now.
Therefore, Sri Ishopanishad advises us not to bother with any destination within the dark material universe, but to try to reflect and reach the effulgent kingdom of God. There are many pseudo-worshippers who become religionists only for the sake of name and fame. Such pseudo-religionists do not wish to get out of this universe and reach the spiritual sky. They only want to maintain the status quo in the material world under the garb of worshipping the Lord. The atheists and impersonalists lead such foolish pseudo-religionists into the darkest regions by preaching a kind of atheism. The atheist directly denies the existence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and the impersonalists support the atheist by stressing the impersonal aspect of the Supreme Lord. Thus far, we have not come across any mantra in Sri Ishopanishad in which the Supreme Personality of Godhead is denied. It is said that he can run faster than anyone. Those who are running after other planets are certainly persons, and if the Lord can run faster than, how can he be impersonal? The impersonal conception of the Supreme Lord is another form of ignorance arising from an imperfect conception of the Absolute Truth.
Correct. Thank you. Let's go back to the slide deck. And now, Prabhupada have changed his gears and Prabhupada is going to talk about the pseudo-religionists and impersonal worshippers. Before we get into that, let's discuss a little bit more in detail about demigod worship. I'm going to raise following questions and we'll take a look from primarily from Bhagavad Gita for the answers. First is, what is demigod worship? Is demigod worship encouraged in scriptures? Third, why demigod worship is simultaneously rejected in the scriptures? And you can call it as a fourth question, not necessarily, but what is the significance of demigod worship? What is the need, not significant, what is the need of it? You know, why it has to be there when it has to be rejected? So some of this kind of a question we'll take a look, and plus why the demigod worshippers are considered less intelligent. So we're going to quote from Bhagavad Gita largely and let's read out set of verses with the purports that Prabhupada writes. Very, very beautiful and important verses. So let's recite line after line. Yo, yo, yam, yam, tanum, bhakta.
Yo, yo, yam, yam, tanum, bhakta.
Shraddhaya architam icchati.
Shraddhaya architam icchati.
Tasya tasya chalam shraddha.
Tasya tasya chalam shraddha.
Tameva vidadhamiham.
Tameva vidadhamiham.
So very interesting, Lord Shri Krishna says in 7th chapter verse 21, Arjuna, it is I who strengthens the faith of the worshipper towards his devata. It is only by my blessing the faith of a Shiva bhakta becomes steady on Shiva. or the faith of a Durga worshipper becomes steady on Durga. Without my blessing, it is not possible. Let's take a look at the purport. Please, somebody read out now. Why Krishna does like this?
God has given independence to everyone. Therefore, if a person desires to have material enjoyment and wants very sincerely to have such facilities from the material demigods, the Supreme Lord, a super soul in everyone's heart, understands and gives facilities to such persons. Hare Krishna.
Continue.
As the Supreme Father of all living entities, He does not interfere with their independence, but gives all facilities so that they can fulfill their material desires. Some may ask why the all-powerful God gives facilities to the living entities for enjoying this material world and so lets them fall into the trap of the illusory energy. The answer is that if the Supreme Lord as Super Soul does not give such facilities, then there is no meaning to independence. Therefore, He gives everyone full independence, whatever one likes. But this ultimate instruction we find in the Bhagavad Gita was to give up all other engagements and fully surrender unto Him. That will make man happy. Both the living entity and the demigods are subordinate to the will of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore, the living entity cannot worship the demigod by his own desire, nor can the demigod bestow any benediction without the Supreme Will. As it is said, not a blade of grass moves without the will of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Generally, persons who are distressed in the material world go to the demigod as they are advised in the Vedic literature.
Alright, before we proceed further, two very important points that Prabhupada mentioned in the purport. First is, Supreme Personality Godhead provides every living entity with an independence. Independence will not have any meaning if the Lord would have to dictate His terms only. Now, when an independence is given, there is a system given in the Vedic scriptures. When a person is in distress, he can either go to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Akama Sarvakamava Moksha Kama Udharidi Tivrena Bhakti Yogena Yajate Sa Purusha Param. So second canto Srimad Bhagavata talks about akama, you do not have any desires. Sarvakamava, you have any and every material desire. In any condition, you should approach the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Simultaneously, for different desires, to get a son, to get a daughter, get a good education, different kind of material desires, for the fulfillment of that, again the Vedas prescribed worship of certain devatas for it. Because independence has been provided, and freedom and opportunity to choose is also provided by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Yet, the caveat is, it cannot happen until the sanction of the Supreme Personality of Godhead comes. In other words, it is the Supreme Personality of Godhead who brings the worshipper and the worshipful devata together. It is only by His blessing. How? The Supreme Personality of Godhead gives the living entity the independence and the determination, in other words, by making his faith steady on the Lord, on the devata, and then he empowers the devata to fulfill the desires of the living entity. Because even this devata is independent, or is devata is dependent on the Supreme Lord. Only by the mercy of the Supreme Lord, he is able to fulfill all the required wish list of the living entity. Let's go ahead further. Let's read what Prabhupada writes in the purport again. Please, Prabhu, continue.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yes, Mother, please go ahead.
A person wanting some particular thing may worship such and such a demigod. For example, a deceased person is recommended to worship the sun god. A person wanting education may worship the goddess of learning, Saraswati. And a person wanting a beautiful wife may worship the goddess Uma, the wife of Lord Shiva. In this way, there are recommendations in the Shastras, Vedic scriptures, for different modes of worship of different demigods. And because a particular living entity wants to enjoy a particular material facility, the Lord inspires him with a strong desire to achieve that benediction from that particular demigod, and so he successfully receives the benediction. The particular mode of the devotional attitude of the living entity toward a particular type of demigod is also arranged by the Supreme Lord. The demigods cannot infuse the living entities with such an affinity, but because He is the Supreme Lord or the Super Soul who is present in the hearts of all living entities, Krishna gives impetus to work man to worship certain demigods. The demigods are actually different parts of the universal body of the Supreme Lord. Therefore, they have no independence.
Conclude the this puppet.
In the Vedic literature, it is stated the Supreme Personality of Godhead as Super Soul is also present within the heart of the demigod. Therefore, he arranges through the demigod to fulfill the desires of the living entity. But both the demigod and the living entity are dependent on the Supreme Will. They are not independent.
Hare Krishna. So, these are some very important verses from Bhagavad Gita. We just read one of that verse in the purport. So, devtas or the living entities, both are asambhutim. They are at all times dependent. And it is Krishna who strengthens the faith of the worshipper to worship the deity that he wants to worship. And why they want to worship the devatas? To get some material desire fulfilled. Let's take a look at one or two more verses in the section. Then the 22nd verse of the 7th chapter, it says, Sataya shaddhaya yuktas
Sataya shaddhaya yuktas
Tasya aradhanam ihate
Tasya aradhanam ihate
Labate cha tatha kama
Labate cha tatha kama
Mayeva vihita hita
Mayeva vihita hita.
Translation please. Who bestows the benedictions for which the worshipper is hankering for? That is being described here. Please read.
Endowed with such a faith, he endeavors to worship a particular demigod and obtains his desires. But in actuality, these benefits are bestowed by me alone.
Go ahead.
The demigods cannot award benedictions to their devotees without the permission of the Supreme Lord.
So according to Bhagavad Gita, very categorically it is mentioned, devatas cannot award benedictions without the sanction of the Supreme Lord. Therefore, devatas are said to be asambhutim, which means dependent. Krishna swarat asambhutim. I hope this is very clear. Many times people would ask this question, what's wrong with this con? Why they say you cannot worship this and that? That we'll discuss probably at the end of the session today about when we talk about the history of Mayavad and also the current situation of the Mayavad, the modern state of Mayavad right now, and what kind of a, a variant of Mayavad which is available. That time we'll discuss this. Maybe before we get into it, just to bring a little, just to add a little spice to our discussion, let me ask all of you, if in case anyone knows the definition of Hinduism. Does anyone know Hinduism? This is being established by, or this is being given by Veer Savarkar, founding member of RSS, right? If I'm correct, he had written a book in 1922, Hindu Rashtra, something like was the title. Anyone has any clue about what Hinduism is? All our life we have probably said others we are Hindu. Well, what does actually Hinduism means? So according to this definition which was given by V. Savarkarji, he explains the people of this subcontinent, Indian subcontinent, who believe in Vedic scriptures and who believe in the devatas are said to be Hindus. This is, mota-mota definition. May not be precise to details. Now, a question comes. And after 1947, we got independence. Maybe after that, we could have had established Lord Shri Krishna or Lord Ram to be the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Even the RSS ideology does not establish that. RSS ideology is based on Vivekananda's philosophy of life, of understanding of what scriptures are. So why, what's the whole idea of this era, the modern day Hinduism? What's the understanding of it? For example, as you understand, RSS was a political uprising, you can say, against British. And for that, they had to bring people all together. And of course, yeah, Visavaka in his definition of Hinduism also say Buddhism, Jainism is also called as Hinduism, and including Sikhism. Any religion which has taken birth in Indian subcontinent is also a part of Hinduism. This is what they kind of, you know. So the whole idea was, if they would not have defined this to such a detail, then people of Jainism faith, Buddhistic faith, and remaining Hinduism faith would have fought with each other. Political parties would have taken advantage of creating divisions. You know, saying that, you know, we want a separate state for Jainism. We want a separate state for Buddhism. Just like we do it amongst different religions. That's the reason this kind of a definition was given. Now my question arises, why they did not acknowledge, establish, why they had to follow Vivekananda's model of understanding of spiritual life or understanding of Hinduism. We had great personalities like Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur, Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Why didn't they acknowledge and establish their ideology based on Bhaktivinoda Thakur's teachings or Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur teachings? But why rather they chose Vivekananda? Well, Vivekananda ji had actually, you know, he was, you can say, a modern day Mayavad, who had no idea, who had no faith in Vedic scriptures itself. He used to say, what will you get by watering the Tulsi plant? Rather, you should water eggplant. At least you'll get an eggplant to eat. And Bengalis love bagan, bagan bharta. So he'll say, what will you get by watering Tulsi plant? At least water eggplant tree, you'll get eggplant. Like that he would speak about it. He will deride or make laugh of, you know, the Vedic practices. What will you get by worshipping the idols? You should rather do manav seva. What is the use of madhav seva? Manav seva hi sarvashesht hai. We will talk about it in a short while, how it all started, this kind of a slogans. So this sounded more appropriate for the, you know, for creating this political movement around Hinduism. Why? Because there cannot be any friction created, because all God are same. Your God, I am God, and all God are same. So how do you divide people? But imagine if they would have chosen Vaishnavism or Vaishnava's ideology, then the Shaivites would have fought with them, which means the followers of the Devi. Then Shaivites and Shaktas. The Shaivites means followers of Lord Shiva, and Shaktas means followers of Devi. They would have fought. That's the reason they chose, considering to the situation, they chose Vivekananda's teachings as their basis of their ideology. And that's how the modern India has been created, where there is a complete hodgepodge. Nobody understands who is God. Is there God, or everyone is God? God is outside, God is inside. Total confusion exists on the subject of God. And that is how the Christians exploited on the name of saying that you people do not know. There are too many gods, but we have one God. Accept it and make your life, you know, blissful. And what is the whole Christian ideology? Is more based on social service, not about spiritual service. So, you know, somebody is hungry, feed him food. Somebody doesn't have clothes, give him clothes. Somebody doesn't have education, give him education. But Prabhupada would raise a question, does it solve the real problems of life? Birth, death, old age, disease continues, isn't it? So your manav seva, if it is disconnected with madhav seva, does not solve the real problem of life. But unfortunately, manav seva is more attractive than madhav seva. Yes or no? People are more inclined to do humanitarian task than to do service to the cause of the humans, Lord Shri Krishna. When it comes to giving a charity to Krishna, there will be hundreds and thousands of doubts in the mind. But when it comes to doing any kind of a contribution towards any humanitarian event or issue, the people would happily give. So that's the whole situation today. And therefore, Srila Prabhupada, through this Ishopanishad book, while talking about pseudo-religionists, is actually covering up all this, you can call as this, you know, religious movement, so-called religious movement, who are on the periphery of spiritual life, but has got nothing to do with spiritual life, has only got to do with one sense gratification. Somehow how I should protect my interest and become successful in this life is the whole objective. And this is what your modern Hinduism is. If it was not for Srila Prabhupada's books, we all would still be wondering why there are so many gods in Hinduism. Yes or no?
Yes.
How many of you have wondered like this? Why there are so many devatas and devis? Why we have so many festivals of this and that and all kind of things? Because of the current situation that we have or the education we have. So let's go back to the purport again. Let's read something more from this purport. Please read out. The Vedic scriptures do not establish polytheism. Vedic scriptures establishes monotheism, one God. And within that one God, there is polytheistic. That is what the conclusion and the message of Bhagavad Gita. Please read out the purport.
Living entity does not know this, and therefore he foolishly goes to the demigods for some benefit. But the pure devotee, when in need of something, prays only to the Supreme Lord. Asking for material benefit, however, is not a sign of a pure devotee. A living entity goes to the demigods usually because he is mad to fulfill his lust. This happens when something undue is desired by the living entity, and the Lord himself does not fulfill the desire. In the Chaitanya Charitamrita, it is said that one who worships the Supreme Lord and at the same time desires material enjoyment is contradictory in his desires. Devotional service to the Supreme Lord and the worship of a demigod cannot be on the same platform, because worship of a demigod is material and devotional service to the Supreme Lord is completely spiritual. For the living entity who desires to return to Godhead, material desires are impediments. A pure devotee of the Lord is therefore not awarded the material benefits desired by less intelligent living entities, who therefore prefer to worship demigods of the material world rather than engage in the devotional service of the Supreme Lord.
Hare Krishna. We'll take one more verse from Bhagavad Gita on the subject matter of demigod worship, and then we'll move forward to the questions that we had asked and answers for it. Lord Shri Krishna says, Antavat phalam tesham, tadbhavati alpamedhasam, devan devaya joyanti, madhvakta yanti mamapi. Antavat phalam tesham, their phala is Antavat, they have beginning and end. Tadbhavati alpa medhasam, they are temporary. Please read out the translation.
Men of small intelligence worship the demigod, and they are fulfilled, and their fruits are limited and temporal. Those who worship the demigods go to the planets of the demigods, but my devotees ultimately reach my supreme planet.
Please read out.
Purpose. Some commentators on the Bhagavad Gita say that one who worships a demigod can reach the Supreme Lord. But here it is clearly stated that the worshippers of demigod go to the different planetary system where various demigods are situated. Just as a worshipper of the sun achieves the sun, or a worshipper of the demigod of the moon achieves the moon. Similarly, if anyone wants to worship a demigod like Indra, he can attain that particular god's planet.
Continue.
It is not that everyone, regardless of whatever demigod is worshipped, will reach the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That is denied here. For it is clearly stated that the worshipper of the demigods go to the different planets in the material world, but the devotees of the Supreme Lord goes directly to the Supreme Planet of the Personality of Godhead. Here the point may be raised that if the demigods are different parts of the body of the Supreme Lord, then the same end should be achieved by worshipping them. However, worshippers of the demigods are less intelligent because they don't know to what part of the body food must be supplied. Some of them are so foolish that they claim that there are many paths and many ways to supply food. This isn't very sanguine. Can anyone supply food to the body through the ears or eyes? They do not know that these demigods are different parts of the universal body of the Supreme Lord. And in their ignorance, they believe that each and every demigod is a separate god and a competitor of the Supreme Lord. Not only are the demigods part of the Supreme Lord, but ordinary living entities are also. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, it is stated that Brahmins are the head of the Supreme Lord, the Kshatriyas are his arms, the Vaishyas are his waist, and Shudras are his legs, and all serve different functions.
So in essence, Prabhupada, through the purpose to this verses to Bhagavad Gita, very, very clearly establishes the position of Devatas. And that's the reason this particular verse of Ishupanishad, Asambhutim Upasate, explains the worshippers of dependent beings remain in the Andham Tama Pravishanti within this material world. Because their position is temporary, their blessings are temporary. No Devata can award us liberation. No Devata can set us free from the material bondage, because even they are governed by the modes of material nature. And only Supreme Lord is beyond the modes of material nature, beyond this material creation, and is the absolute truth. That is the reason why the verse of Ishupanishad says, demigod worshippers enter into the darkest region of life, which means they continue to live into this material creation. And we saw some verses regarding that. Even to an extent, if the Devata goes to the abode of the Devata, the worshipper of Devata goes to the abode of Devata, still it gets destroyed when the certain duration, after certain duration, again he has to continue to take birth in this material world. So let's moving a little forward, and there is another interesting words which will read it. I will not go too much in detail, but the verse is as follow. Ye api anya devata bhakta,
ye api anya devata bhakta,
yajante shradhyanvitaha,
yajante shradhyanvitaha,
te api mameva kanteya,
te api mameva kanteya,
yajanti avidhi purvakam,
yajanti avidhi purvakam.
So Lord Shri Krishna mentions another interesting point. Avidhi purvakam. First of all, they are mudas, they are fools, and they are such a rascals, they even don't know how to worship the devatas properly. They worship them improperly. So, please read the translation, somebody.
Those who are devotees of other gods and who worship them with faith actually worship only me, O son of Kunti, but they do so in a wrong way.
Go ahead.
Purport. Persons who are engaged in the worship of demigods are not very effective, although such worship is offered to me indirectly. Krishna says, for example, when a man pours water on the leaves and branches of a tree without pouring water on the root, he does so without sufficient knowledge or without observing regulative principles.
Hare Krishna. So, scripture gives an example, which Prabhupada is quoting in the purport, is about tree. So, if you want to nourish the tree, where do we water the tree? We water at the root. And that root is nothing but Krishna. He is the absolute truth. Mata paratram nanyat kinchit asti dhananjaya. So when we worship the Supreme Personality Godhead, everyone is nourished. But when we worship only the Devata, neither we are nourished, nor Devatas are nourished, nor the Supreme Lord, nor the whole creation nourished. And that is the point being described here, that how the worship of Devatas is not needed, is not required. Of course, it is needed. It is not that it is not needed. Somebody living a mundane hedonistic, of course, there is nothing called as mundane hedonistic. In fact, hedonistic. If somebody is living a hedonistic life, hedonistic means sensual life, where sense gratification is the only aim of the person, higher than that is a life of a pious materialist, where he at least understands that there are some higher authorities and worships them. Like offering water to Suryadev in the morning, going to the temple of Devatas and offering some fruits, flowers and whatnot. But higher than that is the worship of Vishnu. Because there are gradations, and right now we are discussing from the text which gives us the highest knowledge. Therefore, when you are at this level, or to bring you to this level, the previous level's pitfalls are being described. Is that clear? The Vedic scriptures or Srila Prabhupada purports are not highlighting or not finding faults with Devatas. It is not saying the Devatas are wrong, Devatas should not be offered respect. That is not ISKCON's stand or the position. It just, we are supposed to come to the highest platform of knowledge, we are situated in a below level, we are pretty much absorbed into various worships of devatas and whatnot. And to make a discrimination and distinction, therefore, you know, Lord Shri Krishna speaks about it and Prabhupada's purpose talk about it and highlights it. Many time, many people who are yet not connected properly to ISKCON have this big query about why ISKCON derides devatas. Is there any, I have intentionally read the purports because a very sensitive issue. I just quoted the whole purport. Is there any particular line, even a single line, when Prabhupada is deriding or Prabhupada is insulting any devata? Not at all. Prabhupada is just making a distinction based on what Lord Shri Krishna himself is saying, calling the demigod worshippers as mudas and less intelligent, because by that worship they do not get the permanent result. That is eternal life. They do not get that. That's the reason they're said to be muda, as they're aiming only for temporary gain. Prabhupada is just saying the worship, the upasana practice, the upasana, the practice of upasana which involves worship of devatas, that is inferior than that of the worship of Lord Vishnu. Is that clear? And that is a point being described, and that is how the flaws are being highlighted through this. So moving forward, you can read this section of verses from 721 to 725. I will not go into the additional this thing. Let's come to the another slide, which is now, why demigod worship first of all? If our goal of life is to come to the highest platform, that is to worship Vishnu wholeheartedly, then why a step below, that is demigod worship at its first place, is given in the scriptures? Before I give an answer, anyone would like to share your thought? What is the need of it? If we need to be at the highest platform, why a step below is given?
Probably one reason can be we have heard that different persons in different modes, like
correct,
from tantric mode, rajasic mode, they worship different demigods. So for them, it might be a facility.
Correct. Okay. Anything else?
And the other thing that I was mentioning is like maybe.
So that's the first reason, which is correct, because all of us have got our own psychophysical nature being influenced by the modes of material nature. For every mode, tamaguna, rajaguna and sattvaguna, there are different devatas who are established in those modes, and they are there. So naturally different kinds of people get attracted to different personalities, you know. Even within a family, just like from the family that I come from, my mother was a worshipper of Durga, my father was a worshipper of Lord Shiva, my sisters were worshipper of Saraswati, and I was a worshipper of Hanumanji. So much variety in a family of five members. This is called as Hinduism. So this flexibility and opportunity is only provided in Hinduism, depending on your modes that you carry. So that is one of the reasons. Correct. Thank you. Flexibility is provided, and not only flexibility, an opportunity is provided to align, you know, with who you naturally get attracted to. Correct. What else?
Hare Krishna, Prabhupada.
Yes, Mother Bina.
For the neophyte devotees, training ground is given where they can slowly learn to concentrate and do their practice.
Okay, very nice, very good point. As we said, for a hedonist, to make him advance to some amount of sattva guna, you know, to some amount of religious life, you know, he needs to be given a stepping stone before bringing him to the highest level. So demigod worship becomes a stepping stone. Correct. What else?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, Mithu. So, yes. This is the actual freedom which is being given to us by speaking personality of Godhead, and He is not at all interfering in our choices, and He allowing us to act, we can act according to our wills and fancies. So, this is the actual freedom.
Correct, and that's the point. So, this is an opportunity for the material minded people. So, you know, it's like a multi level options for spiritual advancement according to one's modes. And lastly, it is an example or expression of Lord Shri Krishna's ultimate compassion and non-enviousness. So there are four levels of sadhanas which are described: karma, jnana, yoga and bhakti. karma leads you to heaven, jnana leads you to Brahman realization. Similarly, yoga also. Yoga can take you to Vaikuntha. Only bhakti marg takes one to Goloka Vrindavan. So there are gradation, there are steps like that. Now, before I go on to this, I just want to mention one more point here. Other religions, Abrahamic religions particularly, have a lot of problem with Hinduism or Vedic culture. There are many reasons, but one of the reasons is they call that we are engaged into idolatry, worship of stones. That we have already clarified. Second thing that they say is you have too many gods. Now, is it clear for all of us we don't have too many gods?
Yes.
There is only one God. The message of Bhagavad Gita is not polytheistic. The message of Bhagavad Gita is monotheistic. Polytheism is provided there just to help us become spiritually inclined. But ultimately, there is only one absolute truth. And this is the point on which the Abrahamic scholars would try to, you know, argue against our practices and traditions. So let's take a look at quick notes here. In this section, what we saw, demigod worshipper, what is their understanding? Krishna is another powerful demigod. That is what demigod worshipper thinks. Why they worship demigods? They are unintelligent. They don't understand the results provided by Lord Himself because they are bewildered. They have a very strong desire for sense gratification and they are only seeking for temporary relief. What is the destination of demigod worshipper? Temporary. Why is this a problem? Because even if you go to Brahma's lok, a Brahma Bhuvanaloka, it's all place of temporary. How do they reach different planets? Prabhupada talks about, you know, people are trying to reach different planets by spaceship, by mystic powers or by demigod worships, like that. So, let me ask this question here. If you look historically, there are many, many examples of, I would not call devotees because devtas do not have devotees. You can call them worshippers. There are many examples of worshippers of devatas who were demoniac in nature. And after worshipping the falling devta, they became more demoniac. Yes or no? Any example? Ravana, Kamsa, Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyaksha, isn't it? They worshipped Vrikasur, they worshipped, they got powers and they became more demoniac. Isn't it? Many examples are coming. Can you think of any bhakta who had worshipped Vishnu and who did not got purified and did not became saintly? Any example? Yes?
So that is the case like Keshav Kashmiri who worshipped demigod, but they were directed to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and similarly Chandidas.
No. Okay, I'm coming to that. You're answering to a different question. Okay. I'll come to that question. My question right now is there an example of any worshipper or bhakta of Lord Sri Vishnu who did not got purified? Who did not got purified? Or who became demoniac, further demoniac? There is no example. Okay, let me give an example from Mahabharata. Ashwathama, one of the villain of Mahabharata, because of which he got cursed. You know, Lord Shri Krishna cursed himself. Now this Ashwathama, does anyone know how was he born? Dronacharya had performed worship of Lord Shiva. Ashwathama was a blessing of Lord Shiva. Look what was the blessing of Lord Shiva. Of course, there's nothing wrong with the blessing of Lord Shiva. I don't mean that. But even Ashwathama, the horrific activities he performed. Even Dronacharya, you know, he himself did a lot of sinful acts at the battlefield. Now, let me ask a question for which our Prabhu was giving an answer here. Do you know of any worshippers of devatas who were guided by devatas to the Supreme Personality of Godhead? Any worshippers of devatas who were guided by devatas themselves to the worship of Supreme Personality of Godhead? Hare Krishna, Hare Nam Prabhu. Now is the time for your answer.
Yeah, Keshav Kashmiri, devotee of Mother Saraswati.
Yes, Keshav Kashmiri.
And
Chandidas. So Hare Nam Prabhu is saying Keshav Kashmiri and Chandidas. Keshav Kashmiri, as you know, he was blessed by Mother Saraswati. He could not be defeated by any man of this creation. But he was defeated by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Keshav Kashmiri cried, "Why was I defeated?" Then Mother Saraswati reminded him of the blessing. "I had blessed you that you will not be defeated by any man of this creation. You got defeated by the man outside of this creation." Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu of not in this world. And then Chandidas. Chandidas' younger brother was a devotee of the Lord. He was doing worship of Shaligram. Chandidas was worship of Kali. Right? And he had a huge garden which he had maintained for worshipping his deity of Kali. But one day, her younger brother saw nice flowers and he wanted to offer. But the Chandidas was said, "No, you cannot offer to Vishnu. This is only meant for goddess." So that time, the younger brother, who was a devotee of Lord Vishnu, he did a manasik puja of the, he took that flowers within his mind and offered to the Lord. And when Chandidas plucked the same flowers and offered to Mother Goddess Kali, on that particular day, she appeared and she said, "I'm so pleased with your service to me." So Chandidas asked, "What is so special? Today is Friday, Saturday, what? What is so special today that you appeared to me?" And then she said, "Because today you have offered me Mahaprasadam." And then he asked, "What Mahaprasadam?" Then she explained, "Because today you offered me flowers which are offered to Vishnu." And then Chandidas became a worshipper of Lord Vishnu. Any other examples? Yes, Mithul Prabhu.
Example is Narasimha Mehta. So Narasimha Mehta did an austerity to please Lord Shiva, and that when Lord Shiva pleased, then Narasimha Mehta asked him. So at that point in time, Lord Shiva asked for the benediction. Then Narasimha Mehta asked, "All the time you are in a meditation, so whom on you meditate?" Yes. So at that point in time, Lord Shiva says, "I meditate upon Lord Sri Krishna." So then Narasimha Mehta asked benediction of the bhakti of Lord Sri Krishna.
Wonderful. I didn't knew this background of the story. Correct. Wonderful. If you've been to Vrindavan, there's a very beautiful temple of Radha Vallabha, which is established by Vallabhacharya. And Vallabhacharya, if I'm correct. And he got this deity of Radha Vallabha, very, very beautiful deity, as a dowry. So he got married to the lady whom he got married. Her father gave the deity of Radha Vallabha to this person. I don't know if it was Vallabhacharya or somebody else. Vallabhacharya is different one. But nonetheless, so the story goes, how does Radha Vallabha deity came in this planet or on this in the Vrindavan? So the father of the girl was a great devotee of Lord Shiva. And he had worshipped Lord Shiva for a long, long time, and after which Lord Shiva was pleased and he appeared to him once. And he said that, "I'm very pleased by your bhakti, by your devotion, by your service. Ask for any benediction." So this devotee said, "My dear Lord Shiva, please bless me or please award me your dearmost thing. Whatever is most dear to you, give me." And that time Lord Shiva gave him his beloved Vallabh's deity. And that's how we have a beautiful Radha Vallabh deity in Vrindavan. So like this, there are many, many examples that establishes the position of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That is what we were briefly discussing here on this slide. With that, we come to the final discussion on the 12th mantra, where we're now going to talk about Mayavad history, its dangers and effects to the society today. And we'll see that after a break. This is already So let's begin with our discussion ahead. We are on the third part and the last section of this 12th verse. Impersonalists who mislead people go to the darkest regions of hell, from paragraph number 7 to paragraph number 10 or to the end. So let's take a look. We'll go through the slide deck first, then we'll read it. Let's talk about the consciousness. A materialist. For a materialist, so my question to all of you is, the answer is to attached or detached. A materialist, is he attached or detached to matter? He is attached. Krishna? Detached. Alright? Let's talk about Mayavadi. So just see how much you have understood. Mayavadi is attached or detached with matter? What are you writing on the, you're supposed to write on the chat box. So I know what you are thinking of. You have to quick with your response. Attached or detached with matter? Detached. What about Krishna? Attached or detached?
Detached.
Is detached. This is the third category, special category. Sahajiya. We have not discussed about them, but I'm pretty sure all of you would have heard about this special category of people who very quickly want to enter into the rasa of the Lord. You know, they don't want to follow, go through the path of Vaidhi Bhakti, but they want to enter immediately into the rasa aspect of the Lord's relationship with the devotees. So we'll discuss more about Sahajiyas in Nectar Devotion, but in essence, Sahajiya means who do not follow rules and regulations, do things as they want to do it, and are highly emotional, sentimental. So when it comes to matter, they are attached because they do not give up sense enjoyment, and they are also
attached to Krishna.
What about devotee? Attached, detached?
Detached to matter.
Detached to matter and attached to Krishna. So impersonalists are of two types. One is called as Mayavadi, second is called as Brahmavadis. So Mayavadis, for them, everything is false. Jagan Mithya. For them, this material world is false. Their own form is false. The form of the Lord is false. Only truth for them is Brahman. That is only truth for Mayavadis. Brahmavadis, for them, yes, Brahman is the truth. But they do not reject the reality or the existence of the material world. They are the non-envious spiritualists who have not yet realized beyond Brahman realization of the absolute truth. Whereas Mayavadis are envious so-called spiritualists who envy or who dislike or who hate the Supreme Personality of Godhead. They're not different than atheists. Who is an atheist? He is envious of God, who reject the existence of God. So they are also like an atheist. But for them, for these Mayavadis, there is beyond matter. For an atheist, everything is within matter, but their consciousness is one of same. So Mayavadis, they offend the form of the Lord, calling it formless, non-existing. Brahmavadis do not offend. Only thing is, they are not yet evolved to that level. Unfortunately, we don't have any example in the modern history of a Brahmavadi. But from ancient history, we know Sukhdev Goswami was one Brahmavadi. Sanat Kumaras, the four Kumaras were once Brahmavadis. So as soon as they got the mercy of a Vaishnava, they progressed and became a pure devotee. We don't have much example of Mayavadis in the ancient history, but all other spiritualists in the modern world are all Mayavadis. You know, today, modern world is filled with abundant of this Mayavadis. In fact, all of our modern religions are nothing but some form or some variant of Mayavad only, like that. So let's take a look what Lord Shri Krishna speaks about a little bit about this subject in Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says, Avyaktam vyaktimapannam
Avyaktam vyaktimapannam
Manyante mam abuddhaya
Manyante mam abuddhaya
Parambhavam ajananto
Parambhavam ajananto
Mamavyayam manuttamam
Mamavyayam manuttamam.
Somebody please read out translation and the purport.
Those who are worshippers of demigods have been described as less intelligent persons, and here the impersonalists are similarly described. Lord Krishna, in his personal form, is here speaking before Arjuna, and still, due to ignorance, impersonalists argue that the Supreme Lord ultimately has no form.
So we have a devotee, Mother Medhavani, reading from here. So I'm not sure if it will be audible to all of you, but you can read it by yourself that way. Is it audible?
Yeah, it's audible, yeah.
Oh, great, 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 great. Please read the translation. You missed translation.
Unintelligent men who do not know me perfectly think that I, the Supreme Personality of God, Lord Krishna, was impersonal before and have now assumed this personality. Due to their small knowledge, they do not know my higher nature, which is imperishable and supreme.
So again, I'm not going to go into the purport. It's a little long. You can read it out at leisure. But we'll take a little one or two points from the purport. So the purport talk about the 7.24 verse, is it 24 only? Right? Yeah, talks about that how Lord is a person. In fact, the 13th verse, Srila Prabhupada gives a lot of quotation from Upanishad and other Vedic texts proving that how Krishna is the source of everything and Lord has a form like that is being described here in this particular reference from Bhagavad Gita like that. Please read out now the impersonalists.
Impersonalists, therefore, not knowing the supreme truth, think Krishna to be only the son of Devaki and Vasudeva, or a prince, or a powerful living entity. This is also condemned in the Bhagavad Gita 9.11, Avajananti Mamudha Manushin Tanumashkritam. Only the fools regard me as an ordinary person. The fact is that no one can understand Krishna without rendering devotional service and without developing Krishna consciousness. The Srimad Bhagavatam 10.14.29 confirms this.
We can skip. Yeah, we can skip this. It'll be a long purport then. So fine, this is, you can read it out. There's a little long purport here. I have included in the slide deck for your reference, but we'll move forward. That's the first point. And then let's take our next verse, 7.25, where Krishna categorically mentions that he does not reveal himself. Naham prakasha sarvasya.
Naham prakasha sarvasya.
Yoga maya samavrataha.
Yoga maya samavrataha.
Mudoyam nabi janati.
Mudoyam nabi janati.
Loko mamajamavyayam.
Loko mamajamavyayam.
So somebody please read out.
I am never manifest to the foolish and unintelligent, for then I am covered by my eternal potency, and therefore they do not know that I am unborn and infallible.
So here Krishna is speaking for both the demigod worshippers and as well as this impersonalists, they're calling them both a mudas. They do not actually desire to see the Lord, first of all. They only want their sense gratification business to be fulfilled. Therefore, Lord says, I am covered to them. Yoga maya samavrata. By my internal potency, I am covered to them. And we'll see that is one of the points mentioned in Ishupanishad. One of the last verses, the speaker will say, Hiranmayena Patrena, my dear Lord, please kindly remove this glaring effulgence, which is nothing but your Brahman, which is nothing but your effulgent rays, so that beyond it, I can see the origin of this Brahman. I can see the personal form of the Lord. That will be one of the verses mentioned in Ishupanishad itself. Please read the purport now.
It may be argued that since Krishna was visible to everyone when he was present on this earth, how can it be said that he is not manifest to everyone? But actually, he was not manifest to everyone. When Krishna was present, there were only a few people who could understand him to be the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In the assembly of Gurus, when Shishupad spoke against Krishna's being elected president of the assembly, Bhishma supported him and proclaimed him to be the Supreme God.
Continue.
Similarly, the Pandavas and a few others knew that he was the Supreme, but not everyone. He was not revealed to the non-devotees and the common man. Therefore, in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that but for all his pure devotees, all men consider him to be like themselves. He was manifest only to his devotees as the reservoir of all pleasure. But to others, to unintelligent non-devotees, he was covered by his internal potency. In the prayers of Kunti in the Srimad Bhagavatam 1.8.19, it is said that the Lord is covered by the curtain of Yoga Maya, and thus ordinary people do not understand him. This Yoga Maya curtain is also confirmed in the Ishopanishad Mantra 15, in which the devotee prays.
This is what I was just quoting. Hiranmayena Patrena Satya Sapahita Mukam Tattvam Pushan Apavaranu Satya Dharmaya Drishtai. Please continue to read ahead.
O my Lord, you are the maintainer of the entire universe, and devotional service to you is the highest religious principle. Therefore, I pray that you will also maintain me. Your transcendental form is covered by the Yoga Maya. The Brahma Jyoti is the covering of the internal potency. May you kindly remove this glowing effulgence that impedes my seeing your Sachidananda Vigraha, your eternal form of bliss and knowledge. The Supreme Personality of Godhead in His transcendental form of bliss and knowledge is covered by the internal potency of the Brahma-Jyotir, and the less intelligent impersonalist cannot see the Supreme on this account. Also in the Srimad Bhagavatam 10.1.7, there is this prayer by Brahma. O Supreme Personality of Godhead, O Super Soul, O Master of all mystery, who can calculate your potency and pastimes in this world? You are always expanding your internal potency, and therefore no one can understand you. Learned scientists and learned scholars can examine the atomic constitution of the material world, or even the planets, but still they are unable to calculate your energy and potency, although you are presented before them. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Krishna, is not only unborn, but also avyaya, inexhaustible. His eternal form is bliss and knowledge, and His energies are all inexhaustible.
Hare Krishna, thank you. So, let me ask this question to all of you. This verse says, worship of devatas is dangerous. But, I mean, not exactly in that sense, but yeah, you know, worship of Upasata is mentioned. Yeah, worship of Devata is dangerous, but the worship of the impersonal, not exactly impersonal form, is that said? One second. The worshippers, correct. Those who follow the impersonal path, which means the Mayavad path, is far much more dangerous. So, I just want to do a little brainstorming here before we go ahead. Worship of devatas is said to be dangerous. Why? Avidhi purvakam. First of all, even the followers don't know how to please, how to serve the devatas. Second, the results are temporary. We have discussed this point, right? All of you have given your inputs into it. The results are temporary. Even their situations are temporary. Fine. My question is, why, following the Mayavad aspect of spirituality is considered most dangerous, which means the Lord is formless. Why is it considered to be most dangerous? Is that question clear? That is what the verse says, right? Text 12 says, demigod worshippers, andam tama pravishanti, they remain in the material world. But more so are the worshippers of the impersonal form of the Lord, which means the followers of Mayavad philosophy. And they are not only said to be andam tama pravishanti, but they are also called as offenders to the Lord. So why Mayavad is so dangerous? Mother Reshma, go ahead.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dhanvat.
Dhanvat.
Is it because every soul has a serving propensity?
Perfect.
And once he reaches the Brahman effulgence, he has no serving. He would like to come down again to do some service.
Okay, very nice. So you're quite close to the point. So this whole Mayavad ideology destroys our service propensity because it teaches about lordship. You're the Lord. So it artificially distorts our natural propensity and covers it up with another kind of a misidentification that I'm the Lord. I'm Narayana. That's what they say. And because we are not Narayana, and it is an artificial imposition which over a period of time is shaken up, and then again person comes back, like Mother Reshma was saying. Similarly, Prabhupada would say, so these yogis will go to the forest, perform tamasya for 15-20 years in the cave, and they'll come back to the city, open hospitals and schools as a charitable work. What kind of spiritual life it is? So, correct. That's the first thing. What else? What are the reasons? Mother Sneha, go ahead.
Person can anticipate according to their own whims and fancies how a supreme is actually. It's like they're not sure like who is the supreme and how does he look. So what is the, like whom do we pray to actually?
Oh, so look yourself in the mirror and pray. You're Vishnu. That's what they say. Okay. Alright, good point. Yes, Mother Vedavani.
What is referred to here is Brahmavadi or Mayavadi?
Mayavadis. Forget about Brahmanvadis, it's Mayavadis. Brahma, as I said already, so question is asked, what is referred here as Brahmavadis, Mayavadis? Brahmavadis don't exist in Kali Yuga. What exists is Mayavad. That's the reason today we're going to talk about the history of Mayavad also. So what is being talked about in this trans versus Mayavad? Any other points? Any other dangers? One thing which you all are missing out is these people, they use Vedic scriptures text like Bhagavad Gita to disprove the existence of Lord Shri Krishna. Isn't it?
Yes.
They should be beaten up. Prabhupada would say, I'll kick the face of that Mayavadi guru with my boot. Imagine. Let's say one of you is an author. You write a book. And there is some third party fellow, he takes your book and he writes a commentary on your book, which totally distorts the idea or message that you wanted to communicate. Making sense? Imagine you have written a value-based book and someone else takes your book, writes a commentary on your book, distorts it such a way that it brings the message that sense gratification is the highest goal of life. Disobeying the parents, being independent-minded is the need of the hours for the kid. But your whole message of the book was value education becoming cultured. How many of you will be upset? How many feel offended? So they are using Krishna's words to disobey Krishna, not disobey, to discredit Krishna, say that Krishna does not exist. That's the reason they are said to be the greatest offender. Prabhupada therefore would say, if they want to comment, why don't they write their own Bhagavad Gita? Why they have to use Krishna's Bhagavad Gita and write commentary and create a name for themselves in the market, isn't it? And that was Prabhupada's contention and argument towards this. Another thing that the Mayava does, first they use the Vedic scriptures to disprove and give speculative commentation on the Vedic scriptures. Second thing, they make whole spiritual life very boring affair. How many of you like singing, dancing and feasting? Yes, isn't it? Everyone loves it. Now what does Mayava says? You perform tapasya, tapasya, tapasya. At the end of the day, when you die, you go to Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. You have nothing to do. Can anyone here be alone by oneself for 7 days, even in the best place in the whole world? Can anyone? You all would like to have some association, some exchange. So, an outsider, when he looks at this whole aspect of spiritual life, seeing that, achha, sab kuch karne ke baad akelapan, sabse khatarnak to akelapan hai. The main reason for societal thoughts in the modern society today is because of this loneliness. And the spirituality is teaching that you will be the greatest lonely fellow. You'll attain to a platform, you'll be totally lonely. How would it be attractive at all? So these are some of the aspects which makes it really dangerous. So let's take a look at it. Mayavad is a dangerous hodgepodge khichdi made up with. This is Chaitanya Charanpu makes a point. It's a mix of impersonalism drawn from Upanishad, which is correct. In Upanishad, there is references about impersonalism. Why? Because Lord exists in three features. So of course, impersonalism is spoken about. Second, sugar of social service taken from Christianity. You take any modern day guru today of any of the institution. I would not like to name it. All of you are intelligent people. You'll understand. From saving Kaveri to saving Kashmir. You have people trying to do all social service. Now, we're going to talk about, is social service bad? Prabhupada mentioned the Prabhupada. No, social service is not bad. Social service by itself, all at all, is bad. Because how much ever you try to resolve controversies and conflicts of this world, there is no end to conflict. If we do not give them a spiritual education, that's a problem. So sugar of social service taken from Christianity, spice of nationalism taken from the Indian independence movement. You see most of these people are, front leaders of Hindutva, Hinduism and whatnot. Fine, it has some own value, no doubt about it. Ultimately, envy of Krishna, which they have taken from the hearts of conditioned soul. So it's a khichdi where they have taken spices from different places. So if you look at, let's a little bit give into the background of it, what we are, as I've spoken before also. I'll give you the history in a short while. But Baldev Vidyabhushan, till the time of Baldev Vidyabhushan, we have had many great scholars in Madhava lineage as well as in Vaishnava sect who had fought with Mayavad and defeated Mayavad. But at the time of Baldev Vidyabhushan or after Baldev Vidyabhushan time, then India got more exposed to foreign rule, particularly under British Empire. And the Britishers were the one who brought in Christianity, and they actually broke the backbone of our Vedic culture by stopping our Gurukul education system, bringing in people, fanatics like Max Muller, who apparently was Sanskrit scholars, but they gave their own misconstrued or speculative meanings to the Vedic scriptures with an idea to prove Vedic scriptures to be false and to establish Christianity as to be the true dharma. So their whole objective was conversion. They opened schools, they opened hospitals, and they said to Hindus, you are so confused. You have so many devtas, you have so many goddesses, you worship stones. But look at us, we worship Jesus, we worship Christ, there is only one God, it is so simple. And there is no rules and regulation, there is no conflict. How many of you had felt before coming to Krishna consciousness that Hinduism is very complex? There are so many rules and regulations. On top of it, there was all this casteism, that stri pratha and the child marriages, so many things. These are nothing but all the origins of British Empire. It is they created all those things just to prove how Vedic culture is barbaric, and Vedic culture is actually orthodox. It's not needed to be practiced or accepted in the today's time, whereas Christianity is the modern way of living, the modern way of thinking. That's how they did it. And then they were supported, or probably you can say, I'm not going to name anyone, people name and shame here, but you'll understand, you might have read about all of them. And this kind of ideologies were brought in by the Britishers, and when they started finding fault with Vedic culture, in fact, highlighting faults which didn't exist, like stri pratha, child marriage, etc., to that degree, then the Bengali intellectuals jumped in, several of them, and they started many, many organization foundations, where they also started saying, yes, what is the use of worshipping deities? Social service is far better. Nar seva is Narayan seva, Manav seva hi Madhav seva. That's a time when these kind of phrases and slogans became famous. I already quoted Swami Vivekananda making a point. Prabhupada talks about him, that he used to say, why do you offer flower water to Tulsi? It's just a plant. Offer water to eggplant. At least you'll get to eat eggplant like that. Therefore, at that point of time, Srila Prabhupada, followed up by Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, and followed up by Srila Prabhupada, they came and they very, very strongly once again spoke about Mayavad. And of course, Prabhupada also dealt with Christians and different religious sects and brought about and highlighted their flaws. You can hear a lot of conversation that Prabhupada had with Christian pastor, where Prabhupada would challenge them again and again. If you think, Christianity is a true religion, then tell us why you don't follow the Ten Commandments. Then why do you kill animals when Jesus said, thou shalt not kill? Like that Prabhupada challenged. And that was a historical reason, because of what had happened in the history, and because of which we, the natives of this land, had forgotten our culture. So that had to be re-established. Therefore, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, following up Srila Prabhupada, were very, very critical of this whole modern setup that had been brought in by the British Empire. And Prabhupada was also critical of these Bengali intellectuals, headed by Swami Vivekananda and many others, and also the Mayavad, the modern religions, which were popping up like that. So that is how this whole thing happened. Now the question may arise, if our Vedic culture was so fantastic, then how did this whole downfall of Vedic society happen? How many of you have ever wondered this question? Please raise your hand. When did this all begin? How and all it happened like this? So of course, this is already, this is foretold for Kali Yuga to happen. Kali Yuga is the age of hypocrisy and quarrel. 12th Canto Srimad Bhagavatam describes in details about this age. But it all began with, if you take a look at Arjuna standing at the battlefield of Kurukshetra, where Arjuna pretended to be too otherworldly. What it mean by too otherworldly? Where Arjuna, despite being a Kshatriya, rather than protecting Dharma, he decided to practice his own Dharma in seclusion. I'll make a point again, important thing. We have discussed about similar point before also. The problem began right at the battlefield of Kurukshetra on the very first day when Arjuna was supposed to start fighting with the Kauravas. When Arjuna decided to give up on dharma, to protect dharma was his highest dharma, when he decided to give up on that for the sake of practicing his own private dharma. If a kshatriya gives up his duty of protecting the dharma and citizens, then what scope and hope is there for rest of the citizens to practice dharma? However, Arjuna was fortunate enough, he had Lord Shri Krishna by his side. Lord Shri Krishna advised him, guided him, spoke Bhagavad Gita. Arjuna fought. But after Lord Shri Krishna's disappearance, Kali Yuga began. But the symptoms of Kali Yuga had already manifested, just like Arjuna had exhibited, then Parikshit Maharaj exhibited when he had offended a Brahmana, like that. Symptoms were manifesting. And that the symptom, this was symptoms from Kshatriyas getting manifested, where they did not want to perform their responsibility. And there were other symptoms manifested by Brahmanas also, just like Sringi, the son of Samika Rishi, who Parikshit Maharaj had apparently offended. He was not offended, but he felt, the son thought my father had been offended. And Sringi, although he was a 12-year-old boy, he was just an upstart Brahmana, but because he was born to a great father, Samika Rishi, had that power of Brahma Tejas coming from his father, he had the ability to curse the king of the whole world, Parikshit Maharaj. So the Kshatriya class was becoming, more and more otherworldly, disinterested in protecting dharma. The Brahminical class was becoming more and more proud, more and more arrogant. And that is how the collapse of a society began. There, in this particular episode, Prabhupada mentions that in Kali Yuga, many of the demonic class of people took birth in the Brahmana class in Kali Yuga. And the situation became so worse, up to 2500 years later Kali Yuga started, or 2500 years before, when Gautam Buddha had to appear, Buddha had to appear, the situation was such, the Brahmanas were eating meat. The Brahmanas were quoting scriptures and they were eating meat. And to establish the principle of Ahimsa, one of the pillars of Dharma, Buddha appeared. So Buddhism is not necessarily atheism. It's not necessarily atheism because Buddha just never ever spoke about God. So you can call it as non-theistic in a precise language. High level, today practice of Buddhism is atheism, which the larger society of the people practices is atheism. But Buddha did not establish atheism. Buddha abolished Vedic scriptures because Brahmanas were using Vedic scriptures to commit such kind of a slaughtering of animals, innocent animals, on the name of yajna and sacrifices. He established the principle Ahimsa, but he never spoke about God. So like that, gradually, as we see, Lord Buddha established the principle of Ahimsa, Buddhism started. But because Brahmanas had become corrupted, now Brahmanas are said to be the head of the society. They were the advisors of the kings, Kshatriyas. And when the advisors are corrupted, just like Kamsa had corrupt advisors. Kamsa, when Vasudev had brought his first son to Kamsa, Kamsa had let go Vasudev and Devaki. But immediately the next morning advisors came and again corrupted the mind of Kamsa. And he again brought back Vasudev and Devaki into the prison house. When advisors becomes corrupted, just like Mantra to Kekayi, then what will you do? So similarly, kings become corrupted. And gradually, the whole downfall of the Vedic society happened, particularly accelerated by the Kali Yuga influence. So here I also want to let's talk about a little bit of the history of how Mayava started. This is how the whole Vedic culture collapsed. We are talking about Buddha, so let me just see if is in the presentation. We talk about, yes. So you see on the presentation, is visible? Yeah. So let's take a look a little bit of history of Mayavad now. How history of Mayavad? So Buddha came 2500 years ago. He established Buddhism, uprooted or, pushed aside the whole Vedic, the teachings of Vedic scriptures. And for almost close to 1500 years, a long time, After 500 years, Ashoka came. When Ashoka came after 500 years of Buddha, Ashoka came, then he became Buddhist, and Ashoka was the ruler of the larger part of India, up to Asia literally. Then the whole part, the whole country within his fold became Buddhist. That's the reason when Shankaracharya, who is a representation or expansion of Lord Shiva, when he appeared 1,000 years before, that's the reason when you travel now to Badrinath, to Kedarnath, to Rameshwaram, to Dwarka, to Jagannath Puri, everywhere all over India you go, you see people giving credit to Shankaracharya for re-establishing temple. Yes or no? You heard it? Why? Because for 1500 long years, because of the spread of Buddhism, which is like a non-theistic religion, which means there was no worship of devatas. There were no worship of demigods, or there were no worship of the Lord. And that's the reason, there was no support system present from the ruling class, that the temples, the deities were missing, the temples got destroyed. That was the whole thing. So Shankaracharya came 1,000 years before, and then he came. Now he had to fight. He cannot bring theism immediately, right? You can understand the prevalent Buddhism at that point of time as to prevalent science. Just like all of us are, we say if science says, we believe it, right? Yes or no?
Yeah.
We have so much faith in science. If science acknowledges, we'll know it. So like modern youth today is so much mad after science. Similarly, at that point of time, people were into Buddhistic teachings. So how do you counter argue? At that point of time, to bring the highest truth, the worship of Vishnu, it just cannot be possible. So Lord Shiva as Shankaracharya, he introduced the Vedic scriptures back again by explaining, you are God, I am God. And that was the origin of Mayavad. The origin of Mayavad was to bring in Vedic scriptures. But today, Mayavad have taken that whole scriptures out of context, where they say the God does not exist. So he introduced Mayavad concept, you are God, I am God. This existence is false, because Buddhism says Shunyavadi. According to Buddhism, when you die, what happens? It's Shunyavadi. There's nothing after that. And what did Shankaracharya said? What is Mayavad says? When you die, then you become one with Brahman. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. He just gave them little additional than what they knew. He said it's not Shunyavadi, but it is Om Shanti Shanti platform. So that went on for some time. And of course, because of the charismatic personality of Shankaracharya, although he lived only for 32 years, he traveled all over the land of Bharatvarsha and was able to establish philosophy of oneness, where I and you all are one with the Supreme Lord. So we are one, there is no difference, to the larger part of India. And to debunk it, to bring the right message of scriptures, then 200 years later of that, Ramanujacharya came. And Ramanujacharya established Vishisht Advaita. Shankaracharya had established Advaita. Advaita means non-dual. And then Ramanujacharya came and he established Vishisht Dvaitavad, which means we are one yet different than the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Ramanujacharya traveled, he wrote a lot of commentaries, he wrote on Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita, etc. And then he established that Narayan, we are not Narayan. Narayan is the only truth. We are all his part and parcel. And then came another 150 years down the line, came Madhavacharya. This is all happening in South India. Madhavacharya came and then he established another extreme of it, where he said, everything is different. Every jiva is unique. Jiva and Prakriti is different. Jiva and Ishwar is different. So Shankaracharya had presented one extreme philosophy where he said everything is one. Madhavacharya presented another end of the spectrum where he said everything is dual, everything is different. And then another 250 odd years ahead, then came Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who reconciled both of these extremes and brought in Achintya Bheda Abheda Tattva, which established simultaneously oneness, simultaneously difference. We are one in quantity but different in quality. And that is what was further taken on by Srila Jiva Goswami today, his appearance day, who further elaborated and, you know, established this principle through his elaborate writings called as Sandharva, Bhagavat Sandharva, Paramatma Sandharva. Like that, he has written six kind of Sandharvas where he establishes. So this is the brief of it. I hope this is making sense. Let me go back to the presentation. Let me show you some more things over there. So Upanishads as a stepping stone, medieval spread of Mayavad. Now when it comes to Mayavad, there are two questions that they cannot answer. If in case ever you ever meet them, you can always ask them. You ask them, if everything is false, from where did this falsehood got created? Right? Everything has created, must be a source. Brahman is a source of everything. If this material creation is false, everything is false, from where did this falsehood got created? The only possible answer is the Brahman must have created, but Brahman is non-dual because Atma is not divisible. If Atma is not divisible, how can Atma can get divided or Brahman can get divided and create a false reality? And second thing, if they say, we are God, if you are God, then how are you put under illusion? If you are put under illusion, which means illusion should be greater than Brahman. So when you ask this question, they'll say, these are some of the very complex realities of life which you cannot understand until you become Narayana. So like they try to pass on this question and not answer that, and that's the point here. So his great servant Srila Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada disciple, once went to such forum of Mayavad in Pennsylvania, and there the title was We All Are Gods. We All Are God. So there the speaker spoke for 2 hours establishing how you are God, I am God. At the end of the lecture, he asked, any questions? Ravin Sarupu raised his hand. He said, just very small question to you. You say you are God, I am God, and you say Krishna became God by meditating. But how is it possible when Putana came to kill Krishna, Krishna was hardly 2 days old. In 2 days, what level of meditation he performed that he became God? Then this person gave a very interesting answer. He said, my dear friend, if you want to go beyond illusion, you have to go beyond words, which means you should not ask such kind of questions. Only then you can go beyond illusion. Ravin Swarup Prabhu shouted back, then what did you do with 2 hours for us? You gave us illusion for 2 hours? Because you spoke to us for 2 hours. You're saying we should go beyond illusion. You gave us illusion for 2 hours. And now you're talking about it. So that's a little brief history of the whole Mayavad. Before we go into disasters, there were two other points. Is social service. Prabhupada mentions about it. So social service is not wrong in itself, neither the nationalism, but if it is placed above devotion, then it is bad. Just like, you know, we have statements like Bhuke bhajan na ho gopala, pehle pithoba, phir pithoba. These all are actually, you know, these are non-devotional things which have actually diluted devotion, seeing that unless you eat, you cannot chant the name of the Lord, which have just increased bodily consciousness actually, you know. The mundane social workers may have more compassion than Krishna conscious preachers at times, right? You know, if you're traveling in a train, you will see somebody offering some sweet or something, and if you don't have prasadam, you'll not give even a penny to the beggar, yes or no? Yes? Somebody may wonder, are they call themselves to be devotees. But this fellow, look at him, he's not able to give any charity to this beggar. Whereas someone else may give him 100 rupees. So yes, the mundane social workers may have more compassion than us, but what is the value of their compassion? For imagine if the child using that money goes and buys a cigarette. Is that a true compassion? So what does devotee do? Their compassion is accompanied with education. We do not do anything which would not purify or does not guarantee the purification of the heart or the consciousness of the person. So it's not that we don't give prasadam, we distribute prasadam. But we distribute prasadam, we do not distribute bhoga. So there are a lot of organizations in India, they distribute, they build shelter homes, they distribute clothes, they distribute food. But the point is, when in the history there was no poverty, when in the future there will not be any poverty. So many people came and did so many charitable work. How much poverty has been removed from this world? But if that act of compassion can be accompanied with spiritual education, then the poverty can end, because then that living entity will not have to take birth again in this material world. That is a point. However, social service is very emotionally stimulating, and for that Christian preachers or Christian organizations are very known, and that's the reason they are very successful in converting people all around on the basis of this social service. So this whole idea of social service within Hinduism and nationalism is nothing but the ideas which are stemming from the modern day Mayavad, and therefore this whole Mayavad aspect have actually destroyed our culture and society and have taken people away from devotional attitude. They have put patriotism and social service at a higher realm than devotion. Vivekananda say these devotees, they are sentimental beings. They do not know how to live their life or value their life. So devotees become sentimental for them, whereas they say we are doing social contribution, helping people live a better life is a greater work. Just like there's an organization that talks about art of living. Bhagavad Gita also talks about. Bhagavad Gita does not only talks about art of living, Bhagavad Gita also talks about art of leaving. So that you never come back. But the other people will never talk about not come back. They don't want to lose their customers. So that's the point here. So history of Mayavad we have already discussed. What are the disasters caused by Mayavad? They deprive the natural propensity of a living entity to serve by covering it up with social contribution, social service, nationalism, etc., etc. And they make material life look far much more attractive than the spiritual life. Their kind of a spiritual life is very gloomy and dull like that. So to conclude with, mental speculator, please read out the three paragraphs which are remaining as a homework. I'll give you the summary of these three paragraphs here. Prabhupada talks about why do they do? They use tiny brain to understand the Lord. What is the understanding? Negative conception of the Lord, which means Lord form doesn't exist. They create their own conception of the absolute truth. They conclude absolute truth will be impersonal, and they support atheism. How are they wrong? The form of ignorance arising from imperfect conception of absolute truth, and these are the things which we already discussed. And what is their possible destination? At max they can reach to Brahman, but just as one of the mothers mentioned, they cannot stay there also forever because there is no engagement. Then Prabhupada talks about pseudo-religionists, pseudo-worshippers. Who are they? They're cheaters who become religionists only for the name of Puja Labha Pratishtha. What is their desire? They do not want to get out of the material world. Their goal is not eternal life. They just want to continue living in this material world for the sake of sense gratification. What is their position? They pass or they claim to be as a spiritual teachers, but they are no less than a rascal. They have no knowledge of spiritual life and no detachment from material life. They are most dangerous elements of society, Prabhupada writes. They may escape the laws of the state, Prabhupada says, but they cannot escape the laws of the God. And what are the activities they engage into? They manufacture so-called incarnations of God. They directly violate Vedic instructions. They don't even worship devatas according to Vedic injunctions. They sow false sentiments of religion. They engage in immoral acts. And they no respect for acharyas. And destination, darkest regions of hell, most obnoxious places, Prabhupada writes, in the universe after completing their show of business. To conclude, from Mantra 12, we learn that those who worship demigods or the impersonal absolute are covered by agyan, ignorance. The personal form of the absolute truth, Bhagwan, is fully independent. That is what is called as Sambhutim, and is a source of both devatas and impersonal spiritual effulgence. And knowing Him, the personal form of the Lord, is said to be the highest realization. Why do people worship devatas? People worship devatas for some sense gratification. And why do people worship the impersonal aspect of the Lord? It is nothing but just a mere practice of another form of atheism. These pseudo-religionists who claim to be guru, who claim to be spiritual teachers, they lead their followers into the darkest regions of the universe for offending the Supreme Personality of Godhead and misrepresenting the Vedic teachings. Like that, this very important 12th verse ends here. With that, we pause. Next week when we meet, we'll discuss verse number 13 and verse number 14, where the focus of verse number 13 would be on hearing from bona fide gurus. Verse number 13 is similar to verse number 10, where Isha Upanishad says that avidya and vidya have two different results. Asambhutim, sambhutim have two different results. The result of asambhutim have been explained. In next verse it is mentioned that result of asambhuti, sambhuti is both different. But how do we understand that? By hearing from bona fide teachers. So in this purport, Prabhupada will talk about the importance from hearing from bona fide authorities. And in the previous purport to the 10th verse, where the similar verse was mentioned, there Prabhupada had focused on the culture of knowledge and culture of avidya. Therefore, in the 10th verse, Srila Prabhupada had written the 18 items of knowledge. But he had not spoken anything about dhiranam. In this purport, Prabhupada will elaborate the importance of hearing from a bona fide authority. Who is that bona fide authority? And dangers of hearing from Mayavadi teachers. So we'll continue this discussion next week when we meet. We'll pause here. If anyone has any question on the discussion of demigods or Mayavad, we can open the forum. We can have that question answered now. Hare Krishna. Yes, Chaitra.
So Prabhuji, you were describing that like we were going through a verse from Bhagavad Gita which mentions that Lord Krishna only increases or supports the
faith
of those who are worshipping.
Yes.
Yeah, faith of those who are worshipping the demigods.
Yes.
So we see that like people have a lot of like, or everyone has faith in something or the else. Like there are also people who are not demigods worshippers, they worship some Baba which
correct
itself as a
Paramatma fulfills their desire. So that subject matter is mentioned in 5th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, where when we desire something, the desire only gets fulfilled by the permission of Paramatma. In other words, it just establishes that at all point of time we are dependent. Even for our desire to be fulfilled, we depend on the mercy of the Supreme Lord. Unless He sanctions, our desire cannot be fulfilled. You can extend this verse to any of the man-made God also. Baba and Amma also. Alright? Anything else?
So Pramji, here you said the term impersonal absolute refers to Mayavadis, right? So, the result is worse than the worship of demigods. So what if it is pertaining to Brahmavadis? In that case, is worship of
Brahmavadis is not mentioned only here. So Brahmavadis is not the subject only.
No, correct. But my question is, if it were to compare worship of demigods with worship of the
Brahmavadis,
so in terms of, because the worship of demigods is also an indirect worship of the Supreme Lord.
So what would have happened then would be a different scenario. It is seen in what context the subject matter is built up. So Brahmavadi worship is far greater than the Devta worship because they are on the right track. It is a matter of time when they get mercy of the devotee and they realize the Lord. So which is far superior than the demigod worship. Just like the case of Sukhdev Goswami, in one way you can say he got the mercy of Vyasadev because through him he got to hear Bhagavatam. And that conception disappeared. In case of Sanat, four Kumaras, they got mercy of Tulsi. They got to smell the Tulsi kept on the feet of the Lord Vishnu. So they realized the absolute truth. So let's do it this way. This is atheism. Higher than that is Mayavad. You know, I should not say.
Is higher than atheism.
You know, I would not say that. You know, it's, how do we? I mean,
atheism
this is
atheism.
Huh?
Atheism. There is no offense, right?
See, no. Atheism means envy for the Lord. You know, the definition of atheism. Atheistic, something is called as, if you look at the English terminology, this is called as agnostic, this is called as atheistic. Atheistic is a non-believer. God does not exist, who is convinced is called as atheist. You know, so he's a total envious person. And then there is agnostic, which you're not sure God exists or not exists. Then there are theists, who believe God exists. So atheist refers to a class like Kamsa, like Hiranyakashipu. These are atheists. You cannot say atheists are innocent. Of course, there are innocent among them because of the education people have got. So that's a different thing. But we're talking about through the terms. So anyways, Mayavad, demigod worship, Brahmavadi, and the absolute realization. Fine. Anything else? Sneha, Mother Sneha has her hand up.
Prabhuji, I wanted to check with you. Like last session, you had mentioned that there are, demigod worshippers in knowledge of Supreme and demigod worshippers in ignorance. So, what is their position actually?
I had described that last time also. I mean, I'm just thinking of an example that can come into my mind for that. So one, the demigod worshippers in ignorance, which means for them, their devata is supreme, you know, or else all the devatas are same. They don't understand the position of Lord Vishnu. That is the first thing. Demigod worshippers in knowledge, whereas, for example, even you can see in the Puranas, you can see examples of just like, you know, worship of demigods are being done only with an intention of getting favor of Krishna. Just like gopis had worshipped Katyayani Devi only for the purpose of getting mercy of the Lord, you know. So that's the point over here. And of course they can have further sub-branches into it. I don't have any example that comes to mind just to really give you a clear difference of it. But these are the people, for example, let's talk about our situation right now. We have taken a one clear stand, Vishnu Bhakti, nothing else, only Vishnu Bhakti. But if you look at in Vedic scriptures, in Vedic culture, there are different vrata being practiced for offering, you know, different on different occasions for different devatas. Because for us, we have set our goal very clear. We are going back to Godhead. That's our goal. Therefore, we have taken to one position of only worshipping Vishnu, not getting distracted by anyone. But if you look at Vedic culture, there are appropriate offerings and oblations are given to different devatas on different occasions. So that is also, you know, the could be a devotee of the Lord who is doing that while worshipping the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But I don't have an example of it from the modern time to help you understand that. Is that okay? People can...
Hare Krishna.
Yes, Mother.
My book here about Mantra 12 says the word Sambhuti Mupasyati. Yes, Sambhuti Mupasyati. Is there an error in that? It should have been a Sambhuti.
You're reading from Sanskrit or you're reading from English?
English.
So, Mother, how it is English is, if you see after ye, there will be an apostrophe. So, that is for a. So, for understanding this, if you go at the back of the book, I believe there would be a, you know, they have that. How do you see? The phonetics is given at the end somewhere. Yeah, you see on page number 124, at least in my book, there will be an appendix 3. You can go and see the appendix C. There it is, okay?
So it is to be read as Asambhuti.
Yes, 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 yes. This comes with little experience with the language. Otherwise, we may just say Ye Sambhutim. And then you'll wonder, Ye Sambhutim, Fir Sambhutim.
Yeah,
both the times Sambhutim.
The purpose have given as demigods, and there's no demigod word in that mantra.
So here, Asambhuti means dependence. Like that. Anything else?
Time for one more.
Yeah, we can take questions. It's an important subject. Go ahead.
Murali Mohan Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Guruji, Dhanu Pranam.
Dhanvats.
Prabhu, just one small clarification. When you are going through this Bhagavad Gita purports, in that one place it is mentioned that all the demigods are parts and parcels of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And the first part gave one example like they have to water the root, the leaves or branches. This is one stand. In another place, we are talking like Supreme Personality of Godhead can do with his senses different things. Like I can do all other activities of the other senses. In that case, if you see this different part of Supreme Personality of Godhead is also representation of Krishna only. In this, like, instead of directly
Holy Mohan Prabhu, you have to be a little louder. Yeah, a little louder. I understood the point of watering the root. I understood the point of Krishna can perform anything from his different senses. What is your question here?
Yeah, question is, since Krishna is able to do anything from any senses, why we have to water to the root directly? He can water anywhere because Krishna can do anything.
Thank you, thank you. I'll start with a small different point and then I'll come to your question, Murali Prabhu. Just day before yesterday, we were having our own study group. Some of us were studying together and from the ninth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, and there was a subject of human sacrifice, manushya bali, you know. So I kind of asked a question on that. I said, "Are you know, when this kind of thing is mentioned, that was going on. So how can a bali of, you know, the sacrifice of a human being can be described as a valid activity in even a certain age, whatever it is?" So one of the fellow said, "The life, the purpose of human form of life is sacrifice." So you got the joke here. So the context was, for a particular yajna, for a particular thing, there is a human sacrifice recommended. Of course, this is in a certain age. So I made a point that how is it, you know, kind of just to do a, play a devil's advocate. And that fellow gave an answer. Because the aim of human form of life is sacrifice. So you can do human sacrifice. So something like that kind of a question is going on here. And that yes, Krishna can do anything and everything with all his senses. But an analogy is created or made here. That Krishna is like a root of a tree. And all of us are like the trunk and the branches and the tree, the leaves and the fruits, different parts of the creation of the Lord. If you want to nourish, if you want to please everyone, then it is better to serve the Supreme Personality of Godhead. If you serve the Supreme Personality of Godhead, then all the devatas will be pleased. But however, if you serve one devata, not other devatas will be pleased. So in that context, the example is given, if you water the trunk, sorry, the water the root, when you water the root, the whole tree is nourished. Similarly, when you serve Lord Vishnu, then all devatas are appeased or pleased. Give me an example where somebody worshipped Lord Vishnu and devatas became angry. Maybe they might for a short term, probably they didn't understand or recognize the position of Lord Vishnu at that point of time. And even if they made a mistake, they did not come and ask forgiveness. Is there any example? There are a few examples, of course, but later on they came and asked for forgiveness. You know, that we actually didn't realize who you are. So in other words, if we serve Vishnu or Krishna, all devatas are pleased. Which is a big doubt in the minds of a common man, which they fear that my devta, my Ishta devta will become angry. Just like Indra became angry at Brajavasis. But here the whole story, Krishna also protected the Brajavasis. So if you serve, Krishna will also protect you from the wrath of your Ishta Devta, if in case that has to happen. All right, Murli ji.
Yeah, one more.
Yes, yes, go ahead.
Rajalakshmi
Mataji, go ahead.
Prabhuji, yeah. But in temples and all, we do first the Ganapati Homam. Like, I don't know about ISKCON temple.
Correct, correct. See, in, as I said, in Vedic culture, these all practices were there. You know, to overcome any inauspiciousness and obstacles. In Vedic rituals also, you know, worship of Ganpati was there, correct. But as I said, in Kali Yuga, in current day and time, understanding that we have come from such a khichdi, such a hodgepodge. So not to get distracted again, Prabhupada gave a direct path. Just worship Krishna, whatever you need, ask from Krishna. Do not go to any devtas. For that reason, Prabhupada even said, do not consult astrology. Now, astrology is a bona fide part of Vedic science, isn't it? So you have to see in a time, place, circumstances. I already explained that, yes, the demigod worship are given, even a devotees can worship devatas. We have an example of Lord Ram worshipping Lord Shiva, example of Pandavas doing fire yagya, etc. They are worshipping, offering respects and obeisances to Lord Shiva and others. Arjuna had offered worship to Lord Shiva, you know, those all examples are there, you know. So it is not to be, you know, rejected. But in today's time, when we have come from a background where we are so much confused, we are kind of partially Mayavadi, we are partially followers of demigod worshippers, there are so many confusion, Prabhupada said, keep everything aside. Focus only on Krishna and move forward, because time is too short for us to understand what is right. All right? That is the reason all that practices were, Prabhupada said, no need to engage in any of this. Chant Hare Krishna, read Srimad Bhagavatam, serve Vaishnavas and the Lord, and go back to Godhead.
In Vishnu Puja also, for Krishna also, we do Ganpati Homam. Right?
Correct, correct. So, now we only do Hare Krishna. Okay? So, correct? And you know, in South India, in those ancient temples, this is there, yes. You know, all temples would have Lord Ganesh in the beginning, which is there, no doubt about it. But you have to see the time when those temples were built, what was the consciousness and level of education of people then. And you have to see what is the level of understanding of people today. So if you want to offer worship to Ganesh, yes, fantastic. Understand who Ganesh is. In that mood, understanding that Ganesh is the same Ganesh who actually helped Vyas Devji write scriptures to glorify Vishnu. When Ganpati and his brother Kartikeya had a competition, Kartikeya challenged Ganesh ji, let's see who will circumambulate the whole universe first. Now Ganpati ji, you know, his vehicle is mouse. On top of his, he has a Brahmanical disposition. On top of that, he has a physical outlook also of a Brahmana. You understand, no? He has a tummy and everything. He looks like a traditional Brahmana. Now, Kartikeya is a Kshatriya nature. He is a warrior. He is the commander-in-chief of the Devata's army. And I mean, peacock is his Vahan, I believe, right? Kartikeya? You know?
Yes,
so, Kartikeya went flying, zoop, zoop, zoop. And by the time Kartikeya reached, Ganesh ji was sitting already there. So Kartikeya got shocked. He said, hey, you didn't start? He said, no, I started, I completed also. He said, how did you complete it? Then he showed. On the ground he had written, Ram. And he circumambulated Lord Ram. And he said, he is the center of the whole universe. If I circumambulate it, I circumambulated the whole material universe. So who did Ganesh ji glorify? The holy names of the Lord. You know? So if we know the devatas and we worship them, then we'll stay in a right consciousness. But abhi na to Ganpati pata hai apne ko, sirf abhi apne ko Ganpati bappa moriya. Only that phrase we know, nothing else.
And also, all these Vedic rituals, finally they do the Kaya Navacha, that mantra is, you know, everything is given for Narayana.
Narayana. Yeah.
Is the conclusion.
All the devatas are invoked just for, you know, taking taking away any here and there some. Just like you have security guards on the door, you know, why do you have security guard? Just to make sure the unwanted elements do not enter. So that's the whole idea. Everyone have their own respective service to perform. All right. Anything else?
So I have a question. So in this, you mentioned about the Shankaracharya, right? He started the Maya of the this thing. So does it apply to this verse? Is worse than the whatever the path he has shown has okay. led resulted in people taking up a more position. The position is worse than the
demigod worshippers.
Demigod worship. So. That's
so wonderful, correct. Wonderful question. Harina Prabhu is asking about Shankaracharya. Did Shankaracharya put people more into a darkness? Mm-hmm. Actually not. Shankaracharya's responsibility at that point of time, Lord Shiva's responsibility at that point of time was to establish Vedic literature. So that people again, once again, develop faith in Vedic literature. Now, there are always entities who are envious of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was supposed to come 600 down the line. So he didn't want these kind of envious people to interfere in his path. Just like if you have a terrace, I don't know now, but old, you know, previous age, previous generations, let's say, I remember seeing it at my nani's house, they had a huge bungalow. You know, earlier there, people used to have huge houses. Not a house, it used to be a huge bungalow. Like spread almost in around 10,000 square feet area, whatnot. So they had a huge terrace. On top of the terrace, they had kept a place where they'll go and throw wheat. And only at that place the crow will come and do, after eating, digest and do their business and go away. You understand, right? Why they did it? If they would not do it, then the crow will go all over the terrace and pasture and go away. That will destroy the whole of the terrace. So in one corner of the terrace, they'll go and throw the wheat, so crow will come only. Crow or the, what is that? Pigeon. Not the crow, the pigeon. Kabutar, pigeon. They do the most dirty thing. So pigeon will come into one corner, they'll eat, they'll pass their stool and they'll go away. And the rest of the terrace will be all clean. So one of the responsibility of Shankaracharya was to get this bunch of envious people aside so that they stay focused on this aspect of the Lord does not exist, the Lord is formless and all that. So they do not interfere when the Rasacharya, when Rasa Tattva would be introduced by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu later on. And they would not unnecessarily finger and spoil that. That's the reason Srila Rupa Goswami in prayers, if you see, they say, my dear Lord, please protect this creation or this literature that I'm writing from this mundane scholars. So they do not spoil it by giving their unnecessary commentary. First thing. Second thing, Shankaracharya as per se did not establish the Mayavad all in all. He had just given the seed of it. Because Shankaracharya is the same person who glorified Bhagavad Gita by writing Gita Mahatmya. Shankaracharya was the same person who wrote Govindam, what is that? Bhaja Govindam prayers. But it was the people, the followers. It was Shankaracharya who established all the temples of Lord Vishnu. But it was the followers who had not understood the message. And as down the line, it became more and more corrupted. You know? And that's what happens with anything. In anything in this world, as the time moves forward, gets deteriorated. So gradually it became more and more deteriorated. That's the point. And first thing, as I said, Shankaracharya's one thing was to take all these envious people aside so they do not destroy the rest of the spiritual path. Okay. These are the two things. But an important question.
So,
thank you.
Add on to this.
Yes.
We are criticizing the Maya of this. Okay. So, but what about the current Vedic system available, like for any protection of these Vedic concepts, like cow protection or the Ram Mandir, those are the Mayavadis who come and fight in the forefront. They are in the forefront. Without them, whatever the Vaishnavas depend on, call the Vedic culture, cannot be, whatever little, cannot be protected. So why we should be so harsh on them?
Another thoughtful question Harina Prabhu is asking. I'm just repeating it. I don't know if you all are able to hear. Are you able to hear Harina Prabhu?
Yes.
Samne baith ke yes bol rahe hain. Aduti hai. So those who are online, they're not able to hear, no? So I'll just repeat Harina Prabhu's question. Harina Prabhu was saying, that these are the people, Mayavadis are the one who fight for the Ram temple, they're the one who fight for, Go Raksha and all that. See, you have to understand, we already talked about social service and the spirit of nationalism and protecting Dharma, etc. This is their main objective. Now, protecting this Ram, Bhumi and all that, that has its own, you know, protecting Hindutva. It represents rise of Hindutva and, you know, the rights of Hindutva as against what Islamic invaders did. Now, tell me this thing, once Lord Ram Lalla comes there, or they sit on the throne, what are they seeing Ram Lalla as? You do not exist. Yes, in philosophy, you do not exist. You and I are same. So their cause is very mundane. Now, Goraksha is again because Mayavadis, they are on Sattva Guna. And if you see culture-wise, they are highly cultured, highly traditional because of their roots than most of the ISKCON practitioners. Because most of the ISKCON practitioners have come from the city life. And in the mid-age, they have got connected. And they probably had hardly any connection to the Vedic culture. But most of the Mayavadis, they have their Gurukul. I went to Varanasi and I stayed in one Gurukul for 2 days. Oh, what a fantastic! It's run by a Mayavadi Guru. Everywhere is Hare Krishna Mahamantra. Oh, not Varanasi. What is that place? Next to Kanpur. Bittur, right? The birthplace of Dhruva Maharaj. Bittur, yeah. Oh, the place where Valmiki's ashram is there. Right next to Valmiki's ashram, where Mother Sita entered the earth. Right behind the wall of it, there is this beautiful Gurukul. If you ever go to Yatra, we'll take you there. You go there, everywhere on the compass is Hare Krishna Mahamantra. I was there in the evening at 7 o'clock visiting that place. And I suddenly heard Hare Krishna Kirtan. And I said, yaar, main to do jano ke sang aaya tha. Koi piche party nahi thi, kirtan kahan se ho raha hai? And then I looked across the wall, there were almost 100 young kids were sitting and chanting Hare Krishna Kirtan. I immediately went and met them. And then I saw there were all Devi Devtas in the temple. Everyone. And there were also Shishi Radha and Krishna. So then I met their teacher and I asked him, why do you chant? And how many times you chant? He said, no, we don't only chant Hare Krishna, we chant every mantra. This is part of Vedic culture, so we chant every mantra. So their understanding is total hodgepodge. But in terms of culture and tradition, they're very much polished.
Smartha. They're like smartha
Brahmas. I would not say everyone is a smartha in that way, highly ritualistic.
Religious.
But they have a cultural understanding because they have, see, Shankaracharya established scriptures, na? And scriptures bring you to mode of goodness. And Goraksha, the cow, milk, and everything is very important for your spiritual progress. That's the reason they watch for it. That's the reason they fight for it. Uh-huh. So, in one way, we cannot compare ourselves to them because ours is hardly a 50-year-old movement. But as and when we grow, we'll find more and more people taking very important leadership roles in the aspect of establishing lost temples, also in establishing in cow protection things. ISKCON is doing all of that. ISKCON is doing protection of temples by opening more temples, you know, by giving Krishna conscious teaching, protecting cows by opening more goshalas and taking care of cows. ISKCON and other devotees led the Save Yamuna project in Vrindavan. But we are just 50-year-olds. We need to be given some time before we get into the leadership roles. You know? Fine?
Thank you.
Hare Krishna. Priyanka ji, yes. We'll take as your last question and we'll pause for today. Go ahead. Unmute.
Yes, thank you. So Hare Krishna Prabhu, the question is, in my family, like suppose there are 12 to 13 members, so I am following Hare ISKCON, my husband is following ISKCON, but my other members are following some already other demigods and other things. So the question is, like when we are, my mother-in-law and my grandmother-in-law, they're following the all demigods rituals. So like as per the tradition, I also follow that. I cannot just make them convince that we shouldn't follow. So what we should do in like future, like because it's our tradition, so we should follow that and abolish that. And it's on 20th also the Bhadra Purnima is going to start it. So we follow the Shraddha and everything properly. So how it is going
to be? So Prabhupada's stand on it was because we are living in a society we should honor the certain cultural aspects of it. You know, your family is practicing certain cultural aspect where you have grown up, so those can be practiced as long as it does not sacrifice or compromise your basic Krishna conscious practice. So do not interfere. Third chapter of Bhagavad Gita says, do not unnecessarily interfere the faith of a common man. Rather, find out ways to engage them in Krishna consciousness and let them grow at their own pace. All right? So thank you all for joining today. We'll pause here. Next week we'll start our discussion 13th and 14th. We'll do that together. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.